gonna be the day that they're gonna throw it back to you. By now, you should've somehow realized what you gotta do. I don't believe that anybody feels the way I do about you now.
Cause I'm up here for a while. We're back. It's time for another year of the GSL Codes. I'm Tasis. Joined with me is, of course, Artosis. And we got a new version of StarCraft 2 we're casting. It feels a little bit weird for me. I haven't cast StarCraft 2 in a long time, not since BlizzCon.
Yeah,
it's good to be back.
Yeah. Wow. GSL is finally back. That was such a long amount of time off. Like, I mean, holiday season is cool.
Yeah.
But I get really antsy, man, to get back to work, get some casting done, get some StarCraft in, and finally GSL being back, guys. We're going to be here every Saturday and Wednesday. Happy day.
And this is what our 2018 schedule is going to look like. We have three GSL Codesses, two super tournaments,
yeah,
and our all-star event, the GSL versus the world.
Artosis is StarCraft 2 dying. Is GSL going to be around anymore?
Yeah, it is. Look right there. We have the same amount as last year.
Nothing
pretty
changes.
Sick. Huh?
Nothing changes.
Yeah. Nothing ever changes. Everything is always the same.
I am super excited to see what the meta is going to look like. I feel like everything is still so new with this current iteration of StarCraft 2. This whole season is going to be our big learning phase. We're going to have a quick interview now with the CEO of Africa TV, Kevin. And I believe we might be getting that translated for you guys.
Will he translate it himself?
That's the question, because he's bilingual, so sometimes he just does it in English.
He's quadlingual.
So we have a new season one, Kevin. Any words to the fans? I know, it's the holidays right now. I'm so grateful that so many people came down. So last year we had three GSLs, of course the two super tournaments and the GSL versus the world. We're doing the exact same thing this time around. Thank you guys for supporting us.
Happy New Year.
We love GSL 감사합니다. And we're always looking to make it better. Also, Happy New Year's.
자, 이렇게 대표님의 한 말씀으로 무대 열어봤는데요.
Best wishes to all the fans.
자, 오늘 이 본 경기를
Science said I'm so happy.
대표님과 저의 구호로 열어보고자 합니다.
I was looking at the guy's sweater and said not enough.
구호 함께
like, not enough, it's the same amount of StarCraft 2 as last year.
2018 GSL Season 1 출발!
GSL Season 1 So anyways, Codes. They said let's start the GSL. All right, guys, let's do this. Season 1, 2018.
Don't have Daybreak the map coming back.
In case you guys are confused.
This
okay.
is the GSL.
I'm so happy to be down here again. It actually feels weird if I don't get to cast StarCraft 2 on a regular basis. And this is, I think, one of the longest breaks we had. When was the last? Well, I guess, when did BlizzCon end exactly? What was the last day of that? Was
November 3rd or something? 5th? 6th? Something like that?
Something like that.
First week of November.
We're back here in the new year. It's been a while. We have
2 months.
A new version of StarCraft 2. That's right. This tournament is going to be, I think, out of everything that's going on in StarCraft 2, the most educational StarCraft 2, as far as games go. As far as casting, I'm not sure. But as far as the games go, we're going to really see what the very best of the best are doing.
What they're up to.
Yeah.
Innovation plays today. Speak
that's
of the
right.
devil. Speak of the best. That should be pretty fun to see how he fares. A lot of people thinking Terran has a very hard time at the moment. I'm sure innovation will show us otherwise. But yeah, it's so nice that GSL's back, guys. Help us spread the word a little bit.
Yeah.
I think people are not all aware that GSL, because we kind of like just boop, GSL's
just
pop here.
Up. Also, I know that we have a lot of new players now playing StarCraft 2 and that it's free to play. So if you know anybody who's trying to pick this game, trying to learn, trying to have fun, just watch some good StarCraft 2. Definitely tell them to check us out here at the GSL. Taking a quick look at our tournament format, we could see what our map lineup is. And again, it's basically the same tournament other than that that we've always been casting, same format.
Yeah. Same old stuff, guys. We're on, what is this, year eight now of
getting
GSL.
Close to year eight, yeah.
Yeah. Well, we're on year eight, but yeah.
Aren't we in like year seven, 7 and a half or something like that?
Well, that's the eighth year, right? Mm. You're trying to complete that year.
I like how you're just pushing
it's like
it further.
Level,
that's good.
Level three, right? You haven't completed level three.
Right,
if you complete level three, it would be level four.
Right when we get past the eight-year part, like one day we're going to be like 9 years.
Well,
we're
it's true. It's actually, that's how time works. So, yes. GSL Darkness Sanctuary. Battle of the Boardwalk, obviously not GSL appropriate. So we have our own new map here, as you see. It's a standard four-player map that has no limit to the spawn positions. Depending on the second base location, you can play either aggressively or defensively. Each base has a structure for defense, which is advantageous for early defense, but there is a bridge between the bases, so you shouldn't lower your guard.
There's also a piece of cheese hidden somewhere in the maze in the middle of the map.
Yes, indeed.
Darkness Sanctuary.
Yeah, and the funny thing is, right, like, I was looking at the maps. I'm like, yeah, no, okay, I know these maps, but not GSL Darkness Sanctuary. Like, I looked at it, but I'm like, what happens every time when we have a GSL-only map is it literally doesn't get played or it gets played only in the finals. Like, that happens so often to us.
Yeah.
It just gets vetoed because no one practices it. We're literally having it in the first set today, so we're going to start learning about this right away.
It's interesting because, especially the players in the GSL, they are playing constantly. They would prefer to always be on a map they played the most on than ever taking a risk.
Yeah, normally.
Generally speaking. So this is kind of cool. We're going to start things off with this. And I guess not just the new meta with the new changes in StarCraft 2, but also some of these new maps. We're going to see how that impacts everything.
Yeah. It'll be cool to, I guess, see how this goes. I have no idea, man, how this map will play out exactly. Obviously, it's very big. Obviously, each base has a structure for defense, which is advantageous for early defense. But don't forget, there's a bridge between the bases,
right.
So you shouldn't lower your guard, really,
that's
is
right.
what I'm talking about.
I'm so glad we got the clip notes down here in the bottom right.
Dude.
We'll see if any of that's actually applicable at all. But
let's not forget, there's no limit to the spawn positions, all right? And really, depending on where you want to take your second base, you can – dude, Tasis, you're an aggressive player. You take your second base in a certain place, you can play aggressively. Me, I take my second base in the other place and play defensively. This map has a lot of flex to it.
That's right. So our lineup here for Group A, I think it's pretty tiered. Innovation, I would say, is most likely to get out first. Solar probably second. Leenock Creator, I guess we'll just have to see.
Yeah.
We also have some other very interesting groups. Group
Dude,
B,
yeah.
we have Sort of, which is very exciting to see him
Absolutely.
Qualifying for Code S.
To be honest, this round of 32, the groups are fantastic.
Yeah.
Only Group A and E, I look at and say, okay, these are obvious. Everything else looks like it has really possible upsets.
By the way, this is Scarlett's fourth time.
In a row.
In a row in the GSL Code S, so good on her.
She's going for that Nesty Award,
That's
man.
Right.
We only got to finish out this year, next year, and then the beginning of the next year.
What's going to happen?
So you guys better hope GSL doesn't die so Scarlett can get an
But in
SD
case
award.
You guys are worried, just keep asking Artosis on his stream every time he turns it on.
Yeah.
Maybe Scarlett keeps winning and goes past the number of times NST managed to stay in here, and we have to make the Scarlett Award.
Oh, my gosh.
That nobody
20
ever gets
times
with Scarlett.
In a row.
Yeah.
By that time, we're all 60 years old at
That's
this
right.
rate. But yeah, those are some great groups. It's a very good-looking round of 16. Again, I look at the groups personally, and I see exciting upset possibilities in most of the groups, and that's the best you can hope for in the round of 32 because, like, the top 20 StarCraft II players in the world are way better than, like, the next 15, in my opinion. And then, like, you look at – You look at, like, the top 10, and they're way better than the second, you know, the number 11 through 20. And it kind of goes like that, right? And there's, like, five players that no one can really touch and that type of thing. So.
It's crazy.
일단 새롭고요. 나이 한 살 더 먹는 거에 대해서 되게 슬퍼요. 군대 갈 날이 하루씩 당겨지는 기분이라 좀 씁쓸하고
오랜만에 GSL에 올라와서 기분이 너무 좋고 앞으로 잘해야겠다는 생각밖에 없고
새로운 새해를 GSL과 함께하는 것 같아서 나름 설레는 것도 있네요
민수나 장현우 선수 둘 중 한 명한테만 안 지면 뭐 최소 2등이라도 진출할 수 있지 않을까 생각합니다
초 자체는 할만했고요 근데 개막전을 제가 별로 안 좋아해서 관리하는 것 자체를 잘 안 좋아해서 약간 좀 그게 좀 걸려요
조금 센 조긴 한데 어차피 뭐 누굴 만나도 다 똑같기 때문에 그만큼 또 준비를 많이 한다면 충분히 네, 승산 있다고 생각하고 있어요.
저도 사실 옛날에 조금 줄 몰랐어요. 선수들 이렇게 발목 한 번씩 건드려보는 것도 재밌을 것 같아서 오랜만에 폭탄 면역할 한번 해보려고. 민수야 혹시 폭탄이 터지게 되면 형이 너를 미워해서 그런 거 아니라는 걸 잘 알 거라고 생각한다.
2018년이 오는데요. 새해 복 많이 받으시고
첫 GSL 하는데 시작이 중요한 만큼 좋은 모습 보여드리도록 노력하겠습니다.
올라간 김에는 일단 최선을 다해서 하긴 할 거고요. 지금 폭탄 타임어택 시작됐는데 어디서 터질지 모르니까 폭탄 안 터지게 빨리빨리 돌리고 계세요.
올해는 꼭 한번 GSL에서 4강 한 번만 가보고 싶고요. 그렇게 하기 위해서 노력할 테니까 팬분들도 많이 응원해 주셨으면 좋겠습니다.
Certainly tell that Leenock's favorite caster is Apollo. The ticking time bomb is ticking, Tazeless. Oh, thank you from Germany. Welcome to the studios. I like how we made all the players wear leather jackets. Part of the T-Bird gang.
Leather grackets.
Leather grackets. Right? I'm so sorry. You're totally right. We're going to start this off with innovation versus creator. Creator is somebody who's been around since the very beginning, but I think he was phased out a lot during StarCraft 2, especially when people really started to map out what was going on.
Yeah. Yeah,
but
certainly.
A lot of times when we have a new version of StarCraft 2, I think one of the funnest parts about like a new season of GSL when everything's been changed is seeing if the same guys stay on top or if the new way the game operates tends to favor a different player.
Yeah, well, we'll see just how much this new patch is going to favor Creator here against Innovation. That's the ultimate test, right? Can Creator take down Innovation? I would say no. I think you can take the Marine out of the game, and Innovation's still going to take it, but we'll see. By the way, I do want to mention about those leather jackets. That's a cool look, but all I can think of is this all the same leather jacket everyone's wearing? And
that's the question.
Do they just keep rotating
we'll
this jacket
around? We'll see how it fits on everybody.
Well, this is the thing. Luckily, No Regret has qualified once again for the Code S, and he is much bigger than these nerds, so we will see how many leather jackets there truly are when he gets to play his group.
Oh, man. Is Innovation going to actually dominate hard like he has in so many other previous GSLs? I'd say out of all the players, really, in the past year for StarCraft, or past years, I should say, in StarCraft 2, Innovation has consistently been the guy everybody talks about as the best.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, he didn't win BlizzCon stuff, but he was the most successful player in a lot of ways last year.
That's
had a
right.
ton of tournament wins. When he is dominating, he is truly dominating. Already did qualify for Katowice. Cut through some of the best Protoss in the world to get there even, taking down Classic and was it Hero, I think. And I mean, he's in great shape as always. Now, Creator, of course, as you said, this guy has fallen off quite a ways. Like, there was once upon a time he was one of the best Protoss in the world. He played this was back in like Wings of Liberty, playing
right.
Deathball Styles, Double Forge. Double Forge is definitely a thing right now, but there's no real Deathballs, really. You know, it's very gateway-based, so... Is he going to be able to pull that off here?
Again, guys, Happy New Year, Merry Christmas. Was that a seal in a jacket on the right?
I didn't get to see it for a long time.
Well, he has a very cute igloo. So, starting this off on the map, Catalyst. Again, I know we have a lot of new people watching since StarCraft 2 is now free to play. So, no matter who wins or loses this, both players are still in Group A. The winner goes to the winner's match, and if he wins there, he's out. Loser goes to the loser's match. Giving him one more shot, or another chance at least to try to stay alive in this group. Anyways, guys, GSL, game number one's up. One, GSL Code S is back. Let's go. Okay, game number one of the new year in the bottom right in the blue.
Innovation.
And his opponent in the upper left in the red.
Jenner Greenwings, creator.
So, this will be pretty cool. There's definitely a lot of complaints out there right now from players about the difficulty of Terran versus Protoss, right? So, how will Innovation end up dealing with Creator? We see a gas first opening to start with him, so probably going to get a factory after that expansion.
Creator with an immediate scout over here to get an idea of what exactly Innovation's up to. And it's not uncommon that, especially when there's dramatic changes in an RTS, especially in StarCraft II, that one race seems to be having a hard time. Now, does that always stay that way? Not necessarily. No. There are points in time where it looks like it very well may be imbalanced, and then after a little while, one or two players come up with some completely new trick or approach the matchup in a completely different way, and it becomes very hard to deal with. We saw Creator down there. He's got to get out of there. Creator trying to buy as much time, slow down that command center. And he's actually, Creator is expanding along with Innovation. That's really what we wanted to look for there, to see if he was going to try to double down on tech or aggression. And it seems like they're pretty much going at the same pace. Oh, thank you for that sign in the back from NYC. Welcome.
The other guy says he's missed GSL for 3 months, me as well. Maybe even 4 months. I don't even know.
Yeah, it has been a while since we've been casting StarCraft 2 in this studio specifically.
Yeah, yeah. So, it is a fast factory here. Going to go ahead with a Reaper, check what's going on. Stargate coming up from Creator.
Right under the caution sign.
Yeah.
No, in case he's confused when he scouts it, he's like, I better be worried about that.
Yeah. Not as popular as it once was, the Stargate opening.
Yeah.
But the Oracle is absolutely still a useful tool against Terran. Don't let anyone tell you otherwise.
And he did drive the Reaper out, so the Reaper did not get to scout that and get an idea of what's going on. Again, it kind of depends on how you approach the Stargate. In some games, the Stargate can be something that's actually quite dramatic and can throw a player off. Other times, it's just par for the course and normal tech. And I think, you know, this whole season, in some ways, okay, he's going to come in here now.
Nice.
So he can't get up there. This whole season, or at least the first half of the season, is going to be a real exploratory cast from us, because I'm very curious to see how each of the pro gamers is going to approach this matchup at the highest level. Now hold up, we have the Reaper and the Hellion coming up now. They're going to go for the probes, not going down to where that Stargate is.
Oh, the good shade forward though, and oh, the grenade was fantastic right there, but still don't know how much damage he's really going to get done. The Oracle just going to come out, zap those, nice defensive Oracle play, and no real damage being dealt by that initial Hellion and Reaper.
That's right. Second Oracle on the way. Terran already had been making a Viking ahead of time. Probably an attempt to try to zone that out. And we now see the Oracle. It's headed southbound here. Looks like it might be going into the main.
Well, not really.
Yeah,
going to be pushed back by that Viking.
Yeah, Viking is a great deterrent for something like this, to just make sure the Oracle can't come in there and abuse the Terran. But let's see, he's going to come down here now. He might be able to get a few kills.
Oh! Man.
Mine under the SCV.
The oldest trick in the book right there, Tasteless. And the first Oracle dies. It's kind of an unforgivable thing, especially against Innovation. We have Creator taking his third base, though. He's getting up into his Twilight and Forge. So we'll see where he wants to go from there. But with Siege Shanks being produced and having already killed that first Oracle, I'm very much liking where Innovation is at.
The Oracle once again trying to come in. Nice tag there on the structures to try to monitor what direction the Terran wants to take this game here. And although this is just the very first game of the season, it's pretty cool to see that these guys are actually not going for really dramatic tech builds, but instead just trying to build up very gradually and play what we normally say is a more orthodox version of StarCraft II. I know when Legacy of the Void came out, half the games I casted were completely insane. And we're actually ending pretty fast. I was curious this season to see if we would have a lot of really short games or players pulling out tricks the other players simply had not seen before.
Yeah. You know, I think even though we've had like a lot of pretty significant patches right in a row, you know, since after BlizzCon.
Right.
I feel like it's calmed down quite a bit. Like, there's definitely a more settled meta. It's still, I feel like there's still a lot to be figured out, but like, for instance, you know, Blink is just something you're going to see every game for Protoss. You're going to see these heavy gateway armies, you know. I'm almost a little surprised that he's only going one Forge, just because two Forge is super popular at the moment, and Creator always having been known for that in the past.
Yeah.
But, you know, Innovation, he's just going to have to build up his unit count here and, you know, eventually move out with a very dangerous ball of units. And now, the games that I've seen from Innovation, it's not that different from how he was playing before. He's sitting back a little bit. He's macroing up. Once his infrastructure's up, starts adding some Liberators, gets those Widow Mines in there, and just does these dedicated pushes that have always been pretty good against Gateway Toss.
Yeah, sure. This is sort of your bread and butter TVP here. He's going to try to come up here. And Creator there sniping that Viking, just trying to take out anything that he can. We may have a tag here on the Oracle. No, I'm sorry. He's going to go ahead with the Stasis Ward. There is the option for Force Fields if he wants to do that. I think actually Innovation may be overextending here.
Oh! Now,
he's going to hold his ground.
Yeah,
okay.
This is the super funny part. Like, you can't, like, you should just sit there. I don't think he should be going in.
Well, he needs to have other units with him. That seemed overly ambitious there by Creator.
Like, that army,
and there are still tanks and marauders there.
Yeah.
As good as Stalkers are right now, they're not.
Four Widow Mines also. It's like, okay, let's just chill, wait for this to wear off.
That Stasis Ward did actually slow him down, but Innovation is about to sink his teeth in here. He's going to stim and actually come forward. Widow Mines are being burrowed. We got a Phoenix trying to harass the Medivacs, but it's not really slowing Terran down. Now, the Force Field's there not to try to split up the army so that Creator can cut off a certain amount. He's actually just trying to slow everything down.
Look at that. A little bit of scouting by Creator, but he doesn't need to see what's in the main base. He needs to see what's in front of him, which is a deadly army going after this Nexus right now.
It's kind of an awkward position because the Nexus actually gets in the way of Protoss having his entire army come in there comfortably. Actually, the Immortal already gone with Shield, so Innovation's definitely going to win this fight. Creator's going to have to sack his third base.
This is pretty bad.
Does Innovation go back, or does he just try to keep forcing the issue?
Well, that is a good question, but with this many Widow Mines, I think you just continue to move forward
here.
Yeah,
I think
you
might
should
be
able to just kill your opponent. Charge is about to finish. He cannot move in until Charge is done, but he doesn't even have an armor upgrade yet for it. You know? There are a lot of issues here. He's on two bases here trying to make charge lots to break a push that just killed his third.
There's a Dark Shrine being made, but I don't know if this is going to really be a factor just looking at the rate at which Innovation's pushing. And another awkward position right now for Protoss is the fact that some of this army looks like it might be cut off from going back into the main, which means Creator might be forced to actually try to attack. And oh my god, that was so sick when he shot down the Immortal. Really nicely done.
And look at this. Look at how many Widow Mines are there.
Like, it's a comical amount of Widow
what
Mines.
A cool patch that was to make them build so quickly. Like, this is, you can really see the difference here in how many he has. And Creator is a dead nerd.
Okay, that's it. GG. Innovation with a very standard push coming out there. And that is a cool change there by the Widow Mines. It seems like the role of the Widow Mine is not necessarily to keep a position held, but to do a lot of damage right at the start.
Yeah.
And if Protoss has a good engage, after that, then you can punish them. But when you have that many Widow Mines, the sheer amount of splash damage that goes everywhere, there's no way the Protoss are going to have the damage output, at least in that situation, to ever try to deal with a push like that coming from Innovation. Now, I think what Creator was coming in here with, probably what he felt was a lot stronger, but not as good against a very refined opening like that from Innovation. Innovation seemed to have a very, how do I say this? Like a coverall for whatever Protoss was going to do.
Yeah.
Just try to get a read on him, play defensively, get a solid unit composition, push out.
It's a polar bear.
It's a polar bear, I'm sorry.
But look, if you lose your first Oracle to a Widow Mine, that's just always unforgivable. Back in the day, any time, if you go Oracle first and you lose it to a Widow Mine without doing damage, I mean, you're probably going to lose that game. You should lose that game. That's a big investment. You need that Oracle out. And it just didn't work out. I love the style of Innovation, though. You can see him. That Widow Mine patch has been alive for a bit. And he's been ramping up his Widow Mine production. That game, he had so many.
GSL, we're going to map number two.
Kodak. Darkness Sanctuary.
When the lights come out.
Okay, in the upper right, in the blue, winning game number one.
Innovation.
Silence.
I know.
Okay, no music.
Now we got the music back on here.
Jenner Greenwings, creator.
It's amazing how much that affects the feel of the broadcast.
It's this desolate thing that we're here on top of. It's just like the mouth breathing of Artosis with his stuffy nose.
Tasteless, constantly clearing his throat.
Okay, so Darkness Sanctuary just... I mean, I already told you guys about this map, the second base, the defense of the aggressive, the bridge, you know, guys. We'll see what happens here. But innovation really outclasses creator pretty much in every way.
Well, I mean, this is all to be expected, right? Even with a new version of the game, innovation seems to be somebody who adapts a little bit faster. All the way from Israel, thanks for coming down.
Excellent.
This is a map we, like Artosis was saying earlier, we might not see a whole lot of, simply because it's not a map that the players can easily have practice access to.
Yeah.
But nonetheless, I'm looking forward to seeing how, as this tournament goes on, how players will adapt to this when they can't try to veto it or dodge it.
Yeah.
Or just choose to be okay with it like these two guys did on this map.
Oh, I'm down with an interesting map coming out here. Probe sees a reactor on the way, so that is a bunch of intel that he gets there. We'll see if Innovation wants to go for that quick third command center. He's been doing that quite a bit in this matchup as well.
So far from Creator, it's the same rhythm, at least from the last game, where he's expanding with the Terran. And there is that third command center you were talking about, Artosis.
Yeah. He's been liking this quite a bit recently. Definitely, you know, this is like Innovation.exe, right? Innovation and Maru are the two Terrans that have consistently over the years put out good, high-quality play when other Terrans were unable to, right? And builds like this are always a good fallback. If you have your three command centers very quickly and you don't die, right? I mean, you could die, but if you don't die, then suddenly your economy is, like, really sick.
Yeah.
And you can fight even against a supposed imbalance.
I actually didn't think Innovation was necessarily going to get a third command center against Creator, just because... As you were saying, if you do something aggressive as Protoss, you can absolutely punish him. But Innovation, very comfortable with this style of play. He's been pretty consistent doing this regardless of what iteration of StarCraft 2 we're really in. And let's see if it actually works out. Reaper now coming up, going into the main, does spot the Stargate.
Yeah, full scout.
Yeah,
really
nicely done
there. But, you know, Creator has never really been known as an aggressive player anyways.
True.
He's very much a passive macro type of guy, so... I think it's a fine build here. He gets his turrets up. Like, everything's going to be good here for Innovation. Really looking strong at the moment. Now, can Creator pull something together here as he scouts this third Nexus?
I'm looking back at that last game. I'm wondering what exactly Creator did wrong, if he just miscalculated how much muscle would be coming with that push from Innovation. Let's also keep in mind he did lose that Oracle in the last game to a pretty par-for-the-course pro gamer trick of just having the Widowmine in a location where the eye had... It's harder for your eye to actually catch it.
Yeah.
Albeit, I guess, somewhat predictable.
Well,
he may be more cautious this time around.
These Stargate builds, you know, it kind of slows down things like charge, right? Because you really do want to get blink. Stalkers are just so beefy and awesome at the moment. And so when you see someone open up with these oracles, and then if a push comes and you just aren't ready with your upgrades and all, right, he's getting one forge afterwards. He goes blink and then charge. He's just not ready for the speediness of this push. Now, this game, that won't be the case. It's quick third command center.
Yeah.
He can get all of his stuff up without a problem.
Factories later, too, so Widowmines are not as much of a threat.
Yeah.
Let's see. He's not making a third oracle, right? It's just these two?
Yeah.
So Terran wants to be careful about that if he does decide to move out with anything. So there's a very light contain over here just at the entrance. Protoss doing everything possible to try to keep Terran in the dark. Now, we saw that Innovation did go for that third command center, which has not yet been landed at a third base. Creator is also going for his third Nexus here. So, I mean, it's not very clear if anybody has any sort of definitive lead, really, at least from what we understand in this iteration of StarCraft 2 so far.
Well, I would say, like, if you put a gun to my head, Tasteless, as sometimes you do during these casts, who's ahead? Innovation, I like his spot just a little bit more, right? Like,
yeah.
But... The thing is, there's nothing wrong with where Creator's at. Taking that third Nexus quickly off of a couple Oracles.
Yeah.
This is old school strategy, still works to this day. But, you know, the third Command Center really hasn't been punished at all, so that's a very strong good thing here for Innovation. His SCV count is looking nice. He's got those mules dropping as well.
Once again, Creator, very interested in tagging the actual structures versus necessarily trying to get units, telling us that he really is much more focused on what the unit composition is constantly coming out, not necessarily when they're going to move out immediately. Is that going to actually get up? Nice.
Yeah. Nice little move there. It's quite annoying. Has yep. to run a Marine over there, and of course he's trying to slow that down as well.
Yeah, anything the Creator could do to curb the rate at which this command center is going to land is a small victory.
Did he actually run that under where the command center is?
It's
you have to run it to the very edge to set that off. When I'm surprised Innovation allowed that to occur. But anyways, moving out now on the map. Does have his plus one attack already done here.
Okay, we've now tagged the army here by the Oracle. The command center can finally land, assuming Innovation goes back there to do it. He is beginning to push out, getting some feelers on the map.
His army is ballooning quite quickly here. Gets that Widowmine production really rolling as well. You can just look at that Widowmine build bar, man. That's so fast. Oh, my God.
I think, actually, Innovation's going to try to push in here. He keeps tagging it, so these Oracles are not going to have a lot of energy to actually fight. Stalker's nicely being blinked away. Seems like Creator was a little bit more uncomfortable, starting to realize how much momentum Innovation has. I'm wondering if this is going to be a simple 1-2 punch here from Innovation. Yeah. Nice force field there, though. That's what he needed to do, was cut off some of that army.
There's very low chance that Creator should die here. Like, I know that this is a scary army indeed, but he's got it tagged. He's got Blink. He's got plus one.
And you know,
he's got force fields.
With Blink here and the fact that Protoss are more Stalker-centric, whoa, that was an odd moment where he seemed to force field his own army behind there. I'm not sure what the story was with that. Okay, great force fields here once again. Keep in mind that Innovation is now cut off the third base and the natural here. Is he going to keep pushing forward here? It seems almost like Innovation is very confident that he just has enough. With the Immortal coming down here, he now snipes that. Whoa, great Widowmine hits. Another warp in coming in, but I don't know if Protoss has enough of that critical amount of Stalkers to sustain this.
Innovation just macroing up and punching through right now, dealing a huge amount of damage. And this is basically game.
GG.
Yeah.
Okay. Innovation just has a better grasp on where his army is versus where the Protoss' army is back there. I was going to say, it seems like it would be a little bit trickier to insta-pick up your army as a Terran and try to drop somewhere else, but Innovation didn't even have to use that. He identified right away that this army is, in fact, squishy enough and doesn't have any core damage coming out from it, that he can basically just gun it down.
Yeah, that was... I feel bad because every time we have Creator hit GSL, the games, I feel like the games look like this a lot of the time.
Yeah.
Where it's like, Creator's playing a really great player and he's just not as good.
Yeah, I agree.
You know, just kind of unable to hold on at any point there. Innovation just playing some stock standard games and 2-0-ing easily.
All right, guys, we're going to go to a break. When we come back, our second best of three in day one of the GSL Codex. How can you say?
Shadows too close and I'm still in love. so far.
Africa TV에는 당신이 아는 것보다 다양한 인종이 살고 있죠. 말 많은 인종, 발 빠른 인종, 잘 먹는 인종, 영리한 인종, 친절한 인종까지. 모든 게 컨텐츠가 되고 누구나 주인공이 되는 세상. 알고 보면 멋진 세상.
Are you free? Africa TV.
2nd best of three. If you're just not joining us, Innovation 2.0 Creator. It was about as straightforward of a series as you could really ask for.
Yeah. The one takeaway I think would be the pure amount of Widow Mines that Innovation created in game one. I really like that. I thought that was a very cool way to go about it. These heavy gateway armies to make this type of thing where it's like, oh, your Zalts are charging in. Okay, well, eat Widow Mine shots, scum.
Yeah, he made a lot of those. The damage output was pretty crazy, totally obliterating anything Creator had. Coming up now, we have Leenock versus Solar. These are two players who have been around for a very long time. Leenock, especially hot during the Wings of Liberty and Heart of the Swarm phase, but he's always been very good. I'm curious to see how we'll do against Solar here now, because Solar is certainly a more established player in the past recent years. Also, yeah. I don't know how much Zerg vs. Zerg has really changed. Especially the early game. And ZBZ is a matchup that can end right away.
Yeah. So, I mean, Leenock can be very dangerous. You know, you're going to give him some Lings and Banelings to micro right now. Maybe a Roach timing to hit.
Yeah.
He could make a small upset here against Solar, although I think everyone in the world would consider Solar to be the higher level player in recent years.
It should be noted as well that Solar during Legacy of the Void was certainly one of the craftier Zergs we had. He seems to be able to adapt very, very quickly to new changes in an RTS. So he's somebody I definitely have my eye on, especially this season in 2018 with all the new changes that we have, to see if he has any crazy tricks up his sleeve.
Look, I think that Solar has a decent chance of winning this group against Innovation even.
Yeah.
I'm looking forward to hopefully seeing that match coming up next. I mean, he hasn't been, I guess, killing everything in the qualifiers, but... I mean, Solar is always super strong, man. Very smart, smart Zerg player.
All right, we're going to Blackpink for
cool
game number one.
Huh?
It's an interesting color as well.
Blackpink?
Try to imagine that in your head.
can't really mix things with black
very
well,
exactly.
Right? That's actually the name of like a K-pop band, I believe.
Oh, that would not
surprise
me.
But the map is also black and pink.
Yeah.
I knew about the map before I knew about the band.
Wow. Well, that shows you where your priorities are, Toto, so it's good for you. Absolutely. We're going now into game number one, our CBZ Solar versus Leenock. Daybreak. When the lights come out. Okay, in the bottom left, in the red, or pink.
Titan EX1, Leenock.
Would you consider his hair purple or pink?
Leenock's, that's purple for sure.
Oh, okay.
You see that as it possibly being pink?
No, I see it as purple.
Okay. I'm like, do you see it as green? You're like, no. I'm like, okay, see?
Splunts. You said it like you really knew it more than you ever knew anything in the whole world.
I was really excited.
Damn,
I was really excited to show the stream. I know my colors. They're going to be pretty impressed.
You ready to die over that one, Tasteless? You're going to bet the whole farm on that one? Jeez.
Mirrored builds, by the way, so far. So we'll wait and see if there's any deviation from that. Again, I don't expect the very early game of ZVZ to look different at all, really. Maybe when we get to mid-game or later, they start to attack in different directions.
I'm just thinking of Blackpink being like a K-pop band name, right?
Yeah.
You and I need to start a band. I have this sick idea. Oh, welcome.
Yeah, from the USA. I'm glad you're so happy. I'm happy, too. Everybody's happy.
I'm super happy.
What if there was one guy in the audience who was unhappy? I'd be like, what?
Why are you here?
Why are you not happy?
Yeah.
You're never going to be happy at this rate.
But listen, I think that I have this great idea for a band. We'll call it Brown Yellow.
Okay.
Okay. It's maybe not as sexy as Blackpink.
Sure.
In fact, now you think of the things that
are brown and yellow. Let's do it. Two-man group. What is the smallest number of people you can have to have a boy band or a girl band? Is it four? Can you have three?
Well, I think it's they literally just have the DNA of one person. They just clone them for all these different bands.
Yeah.
So I think it's one is the technical answer to this.
Okay.
The only person they need is their manager that steals all their money. Okay, because every boy band member and girl band member out here, man, they can all just quit the band.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter. You just get new ones to fill them in, and that's it.
You are definitely more expendable in that line of work.
Oh, man.
Wait, I'm sorry. We don't have a Bantling's Nest from Solar here, right? Because Leenock's getting his. Where Link Speed's about to finish here for Solar.
No.
And it's also, it should be noted, three bases here for Solar compared to the two here. For Leenock. Queens are going to come try to drive out that Overlord. But he has to be very careful to make sure Solar doesn't try to run by. The Overlord actually does get on the high ground, so good job buying time. The Queens won't be able to pursue that any further.
Well, they could, but it would just take forever.
Missiles
and jacks, you know, like everything would really start to fall apart if
you went
over that.
It'd be a good educational way for the new people watching as to why you wouldn't want to do that.
He like rushes to Lair to drop Overlord creep to push the Queens forward more quickly. Starts building spores and sending them across the map.
Okay, Leenock now going for this hatch. It will be driven away though by Solar momentarily here. And we have Solar's Baneling's Nest just now finishing up. While Banelings are already being made here for Leenock.
Yeah, in his main base. Though.
Yeah.
So very defensive in that regard. Looks like that Lair is going to be finishing up here for Leenock relatively soon. Nothing for Solar on that that side yet.
And I think we'll see
Mutas. Look at that. He's going up to four gas.
I mean, with that many gas, he certainly could. This is a pretty normal deviation in ZVZ where one player is going for three bases, the other going for two. Solar hoping to get that economic boost a little bit later on. Leenock, in this case, trying to tech into something that's going to throw Solar off rhythm. The danger, of course, for Leenock is if he doesn't do any damage or can't slow him down in any way, then you do have Solar with three bases, and he has a really strong opportunity later on after he's gathered enough resources to try to come out and punish the two base player.
Yeah.
Sometimes as he's taking his third, sometimes a little bit later on.
Now, he didn't see the Spire. It hadn't started yet when that lane got in.
I think he might just know, though.
Yeah, you see this many gases, and you don't see a Roachhorn. Because, like, if you're going to go for a Nidus with Roaches, you already have the Roachhorn. So
okay.
I think this is pretty obvious for him.
Oh, nice. Really good job here by Leenock.
Yeah, yeah.
Only really losing that queen. Good targeting on the Banelings. And a pretty good surround, actually. Solar's Lings couldn't really effectively escape without losing them.
Yeah.
Good amount of them.
Well, I mean, Leenock's playing a solid game now and using this kind of, well, I don't know if I should call it older style, but, you know, it's definitely something that he's used enough in the past that he knows how to make this work.
Okay, Leenock not coming up. He could. Okay, he's not going to run by those Banelings. Coming in here now. Trying to get some trades over here. Trying to stay away from those Banelings. Whoa, good job.
Yeah.
One Baneling remaining. He actually takes out a good amount.
Serious quality Banelings.
This may actually start to snowball. We have two more Banelings now coming up, although two more coming up here for Leenock as well. Leenock on the run now, moving back through the minerals. Drones have been mostly evacuated.
Wow.
This one Baneling coming here trying to connect.
Ooh. Quality play here from Leenock. Look at all this damage that he's actually getting done. Picking off queens, drones, lings, everything.
Note he's actually running by the making Baneling right now. Driving the drones now into the main here. One detonates. He's taking out many that are on the gas. I don't know if Solar's really going to be able to stabilize. He's losing a lot of mining timing, running around with his workers.
Especially considering he's been losing queens, and there's mutalisks on the way. There's six making at the moment.
And already a dozen drones have been picked off. Again, more evacuating right now. And I think the mutas may be the killing blow. We had, as you were saying, we have a lot of queens that have been picked off, so there's going to be less anti-air overall.
There's no spores right now. Once you get eight queens, you're going to, rather eight mutas, you're going to roll over just a queen at each base, right? And without a single spore out, definitely some trouble. Look at this. Because he built two mutas way before the other several of them. So I like the fact that he's taking two mutas that will not fare well against a queen picking off banes.
This is a really good way to optimize them. And it's allowing Leenock to get more territory just outside of Solar's expansion here. He can also, as you can see, clean up these overlords. Right now, Solar's suffering massive losses. I don't know if he can stabilize here.
Yeah, even a goop there on the hatchery. Yeah. So nice play.
Gunning down so many of these overlords. I think he could actually, he could just go right on top of these queens. And there's only one spore, excuse me, over in that area. Now, with the mutas here, he cuts these two bases in half, so he can identify which location has less defense, and then go in there with the Zerglings. A counterattack instead here from Solar, going for this queen, and that's it. Doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Leenock wins game number one.
Very nice.
And what I would say is an upset compared to how these guys are playing last year.
Well, this is the fun part of this group, right, is that Leenock's CBZ, he's dangerous. He can make things happen. We saw that nice micro there. Solar with the greedier build, unable to defend properly against the Zerglings. If he had, those mutas would not have just ended it. So, good moves here by Leenock. And possibly, if he upsets the group like this, we will not get to see Solar versus Innovation that I really wanted to see. And it seemed like in the interview to me that Innovation was discounting Leenock a lot. I think Innovation probably feels pretty confident in taking down Leenock.
Yeah, I think so. Well, I would imagine that the other three players besides Innovation are all just gunning for second place. Mm. If you actually got out first, that would be incredible. But I think a realistic pro gamer is really just looking to eke out at the very end. So this is going to be pretty taxing here for Solar. Already down one game. Going to Catalyst here on map number two.
Yeah, I like those picture frames with the pro gamers in
the jackets. They look like greasers,
Well, I want to see like a picture, the next picture frame that comes up. It's like Leenock being pushed in a swing by like a white dad, like one of those one of those stock photos when you actually buy the frame, it comes in there.
Yeah. Okay, game two is loaded up. This is our second best of three today. The winner does go on to the winner's match to face off against Innovation.
GSL Season 1, Code S, Daybreak.
When the lights come out!
Okay, in the bottom right in the red, he is
Titan EX1, Leenock.
Love the build he's chosen, too.
Mm-hmm. Totally mixing it up.
Yeah.
And his opponent here in the upper left, in the blue.
Splice, Solar.
The counterest of builds that he could have possibly done, getting the same stuff slightly later. Good work, Solar. So Solar has the advantage going into this one. That does not always work out, though, if you just make drones.
Unbeknownst to him, he'll identify that later on. Always a little bit of a poker game and ZBZ early on.
Is it, though? Oh, I'm missing control.
That's StarCraft 1 event we did.
That was so fun.
Holiday bash. What do we call that?
It was the holiday bash. Yeah.
All right. Okay. That was a lot of fun.
Yeah, that was.
Was it though?
Is it though?
Is it though?
So bad. Oh God. Welcome, nerds.
Thanks for coming down, guys.
Standing room only, I guess. Yeah. You guys can take a seat. Oh, I guess not, actually. I'm looking down there now, and there's people standing all over. You guys can't take a seat. I'm so sorry.
About
I guess
them.
You could sit on the ground. That's kind of dirty, though.
You could lay on the ground if you wanted to. Someone might stop you, but we won't.
I don't think anyone would stop them, to be honest. I think you just lay down on the ground. Whose ground is this? Someone tells me you got the ground. Oh, do you own this ground? They're like, well, yeah, it's the GSL studio. Get up. Like, oh, okay, I'm sorry.
So Leenock's coming up here. This is an indicator of why Solar is slightly ahead based off the build order choice. Because these links go all the way across the map, Solar got a few extra drones. But Leenock is actually doubling down here. He's actually making banelings.
Yeah.
And if those banelings get a good connect, just like it's always been,
then, this is hard.
Yeah, this all comes down to how the banelings connect. Okay, actually not terrible considering how early this game is.
Dude, he has to hold this. You see, he has more larva right now. He has a queen out, so he has all sorts of things to work with, but these banelings are so deadly.
Okay, now the queen's trying to snipe the baneling. The links don't have quite the right surround. He may have to just detonate that, and he does. Now going on to the spine crawler. Is this just going to
be a win?
Two more banelings being made. Another spine crawler has been started. There's not really enough drones comboed with links to actually try to stop this. Two links coming down now. Try to deny those banelings, but Leenock is on top of it, completely body blocking that with links.
Dude, this is crazy. He's playing very well right now. Nice aggressive play coming in with the banes once again.
Oh, okay. He connects, but it's those two baneling hits to actually kill off a drone.
Red drones there.
I'm sorry. Was Leenock not making links behind this? I actually wasn't watching the production tab.
He was.
Yeah, he was. Okay, there they are.
It's the first
a little bit
time.
To see on this
it's
orange.
The first yeah. time in a ZVZ in 8 years that Tasis wasn't watching the production tab.
It's the easiest way to cast it, man.
That's all I need. I actually just put paper all over the rest of the screen.
Oh, yeah.
Man. I bring in my trusty roll of toilet paper.
That's a little caster hack if you want to know how to cast ZVZ early on. You pretty much just watch the production tab.
You and then queen and eight lings.
And then you wait for to see where the banelings blow up. And you're going to be casting like a pro. It's banelings, three more about to finish. And Solar seems to want to actually try to run around. He's hoping that Leenock might overextend and be vulnerable here. But Leenock already cuts him off at the pass. The second attack is coming in now. I believe it's just lings being made right now for Solar. Go ahead, Artos.
No, double queen on ramp is just, this is a very good way to slow this way, way, way down. But he keeps getting free pickoffs here. Lings running out. It looks like Solar does want to try to run around and get something done. Can he end up doing something like kill this hatchery? They're on even workers, but this additional larva count means a lot for Solar.
Keep in mind that Leenock's on one hatch, so this is going to even things out in a lot of ways. He's keeping these banelings back until the reinforcements come in. Hatchery at about, I don't know, maybe 60% health here. Could be taken out.
Ooh, some good catches from Solar. It looks like this hatchery might end up falling.
Yeah, and it will. The banelings are actually going to run up here.
Oh, my God.
In fact, if he turns those banelings around, he could take out all these links.
That is true. He tries to do that, and the other baneling kind of going towards this mineral line. Can Leenock do it?
Seven drones killed so far. Coming in here for a connect, and they're also low. 12 down. Well, I think that might be it.
Yeah.
There's one worker in this game right now for Solar.
Ah, he saved it.
All right. He's still got a chance.
And he's got 29 minerals, so he really needs that.
Wow. There's still enough lings to try to come in, but with any good baneling connects, that pretty much shuts it down.
Oh,
GG.
My gosh.
Leenock upsets 2-0.
Hashtag Leenock on fire. Hashtag year of Leenock. What is going on? Dude, he's
Look at Leenock's face.
Yeah.
He's like, all right.
He's like, yeah, you guys all discounted me. All right.
Okay, he can't hide the fact that he's happy. Well, good job by Leenock.
Oh, man. What if he takes down Innovation next? What if that's what happens? What if Leenock wins his season of GSL and he's our Gubiho this year?
He wins three in a row and finally outdoes Sue for how good you can possibly be as a Zerg. Solar looking very concerned now. I think the fact that he knows Innovation is a very tough opponent, the fact that it's already been proven right now that he is more than capable of losing to somebody like Leenock.
Yeah.
I don't know how he's feeling about Creator, but I think Solar more concerned about how he's going to move on to the round of 16 for sure.
Well, at minimum, he has to play Leenock again, right?
Possibly
at the minimum,
Innovation. Yeah.
Who knows? We'll see. Maybe Creator just takes him out. Maybe Creator's the greatest PVC player ever to have lived. We just don't know it yet.
Okay, guys, we're going to go to a break now. When we come back, the winner's match, Leenock versus Innovation. Don't go away.
아프리카 TV에는 당신이 아는 것보다 다양한 인종이 살고 있죠. 말 많은 인종, 발 빠른 인종, 잘 먹는 인종, 영리한 인종, 친절한 인종까지. 모든 게 컨텐츠가 되고 누구나 주인공이 되는 세상. 알고 보면 멋진 세상.
Are you free? 아프리카 TV.
욕심과 목표와 원하는 그림들이 눈에 보였습니다. 그 정도로 간절해 보였는데. 아쉬웠거든요. GSL 슈퍼토너트에서 하늘 불면서 기세 블리스까지 끌고 가고 싶을 겁니다. 지진! 속도함이 집중이 안 된 거죠.
지진!
부정기로 추가병력이 맹독죠.
지진! 뚫어버립니까? 그동안에 한결이 쓸줍니까?
블리스컨이라는 티켓까지도 잡았다고 보호했으면 이런 식으로 넣었죠.
지진! 2017년 유일한 저우승자로
다시 의욕이 생기는 것 같아서 기분이 너무 좋습니다.
We've narrowed it down to two. We start out with players from all around the world. We've narrowed it down to two.
Creator Leenock Solar.
Am I dead or alive?
I've spotted differences. There's at least two leather brackets.
Okay.
At least two.
Yes.
We'll continue expanding. Imagine if there's 32. I'm like, damn, you guys spent a lot of leather brackets.
Those leather jackets, those leather brackets are not cheap.
Let's put them in t-shirts and give Tastosis a raise. That's my opinion.
Okay. We are now about to decide who's going to be the first player to advance in the first season of the GSL Code S in 2018. Leenock versus Innovation. I think it's fair to say most of us were expecting Solar to move on.
Yeah.
So very exciting to see Leenock got this far. But ZVZ is totally different from ZVT. You know, you can have very strong ZVZ and take out a very solid player. The problem for Leenock taking on Innovation is Innovation doesn't really seem to make any mistakes early on. That's why he is so scary.
Yeah.
He always gets to the point of the game that he wanted to get to. He does it better than anybody else.
Mm-hmm.
And then when he pushes out, it seems like nobody can stop it.
Does seem that way.
Is this appropriate music for the winner's match?
Hold on.
We had people sing a little bit.
What's that say? Does that say Innovation? It looks like Innovation. Are you member of Innovation?
I for sure am.
Yeah. Not me. I'm a Marauder.
Okay, Blackpink's going to be our map.
Oh, jeez.
Both players definitely wanting to win this here rather than go down to the final match of the day. Leenock's already caused one upset. We're going to see if he can actually do it again. But this would be the upset of upsets to actually take out Innovation, one of the scariest players in StarCraft II of all time. In the round of 32 in GSL Code S, our game is loaded up. Let's do this. The winner goes on to the round of 16, our first player to get that far in the GSL Code S. I guess when you think about it,
whoa!
We're paid to do this.
Titan EX1, Leenock.
Inception sound effect.
I've got to go a level deeper.
Oh my gosh.
So, in the bottom left.
Innovation.
And we did have Leenock in the upper right. So, what do you think, Artosis? Is Leenock going to actually go for some kind of normal-looking game? I mean, the odds of you doing something crazy and it working, especially right when everything's been changed in a new RTS,
yeah,
the odds always seem to be a little bit higher. maybe innovation is going to get caught off guard.
Okay, you know, normal macro play from Zerg, I feel like, is not... It's not bad. Like, Hydra Bane is a pretty strong composition. Just here for the memes.
Well, there's no shortage of that, my friend.
Not much else, to be perfectly frank. But look, the Hydra Bane, this style, you know, just like having those units, it's not that hard to play. It's not like when you used to watch and you'd have to be having someone like Bjoll or Sue going Ling Bane Muta, right, against someone like Innovation. Like, you'd have to have the very best mechanical players just barely holding off Innovation's advances all the time. You know, with this other style, it's a little bit more easy. If Innovation does want to end up doing something like going mech, Ravens are no longer going to be what they once were against Zerg. So, you know, I mean, I feel like Leenock could play a straight-up game. He's not really known for playing 100% normal straight-up.
He always seems to play slightly around what is the perceived most standard way to play Zerg.
Yeah. I think I was actually watching his stream the other day, and if I recall correctly, I only saw him play one ZBT, I think, before he logged off, but I'm pretty sure he went Roach-based play at the beginning. We'll see if something like that is the case, but anyways, should be fun to see what he wants to go for. Looks like Innovation, very standardly getting a reactor and a factory. This is like what Innovation does against Zerg. He makes enough Hellions that he can't die.
The Reaper's now going to come up into the main here, looking for any tech, any clues, anything that'll show or telegraph what exactly the Zerg's going to be doing later on. And so far, he really doesn't see much of anything.
There's not much to see anyways.
Yeah, no real tech. It's just the Zerg droning up and using the Queens to keep that Reaper back. We also have this Overlord down here in the bottom left. You can see it on the mini-map. I don't think we're going to get a shot of it, but that may come in a little bit later to try to see what exactly Terran's up to. Now the Hellions are going to come out. And this should go into what we've seen in a lot of TBZs, where the Hellions and the Reapers try to just keep the creep pushed back. Mm-hmm. So Zerg doesn't have that much mobility later on in the game.
Yeah, he's not going to get any other real damage done. With that Tech Lab coming down, looks like he does want to go for bio-based play here as well. There is that Roach Horn from Leenock, so it looks like he does want to kind of stay on that style, at least for now, and it's definitely one that he's going to be able to handle. He's going to be able to macro that up pretty easily, so I don't expect him to die too early, but it does make me a little bit nervous. You know, if he's going to put some substantial money into Roaches, if he does not deal some damage to Innovation with that, those are not going to scale well as Innovation's macro gets going.
Yeah, that's a general theme with Roaches, is that they give you a certain amount of power at a certain point in time in the game, but they don't really allow you to carry that into a later phase a lot of times.
Yeah, the longer you hold on to your Roaches, the more their value decreases, unfortunately.
The supply of them and everything
else. They're not a stock that Warren Buffett would
certainly
want to purchase.
Certainly not. It's no Coca-Cola stock there.
No, it's the right amount of time to hold Roaches is until the late mid-game. And then sell them for anything you can get them for.
Okay. We have the Hellions and Reaper coming in here now. I don't think Innovation's going to gun it at all and try to actually just push in. I think he's just going to stay back and try to get the creep. Some players will impulsively try to run and actually just wipe out a bunch of drones. I don't think that's the Innovation that we know.
Yeah, he should play pretty... you know, sitting back, like not overcommitting anything. Throwing stuff away is how you lose a game. Don't be wasteful here, Innovation. He's not going to be. A lot of Roaches being produced right now, though. Leenock's only on 45 drones. He's making Drop Lords, so yeah. He's going to be bringing some Queens over and just going Roach Ravager. Ooh. And, I mean, it's a deadly style to play. He has a possibility of just straight-up winning this.
By the way, great control there by Leenock, not losing a single drone to that Liberator. Like, the last second, he pulls away. And so now we're going to see how much momentum this attack is going to have up here. Now, even though he's moving across the map, these Hellions are now going to come in here. I think unbeknownst to Leenock, the drop... Oh, okay, now he knows 100% what's happening.
Well, this is problematic for Innovation. He does not really have that much right now. He's got to get these bunkers up ASAP.
Yeah.
Bringing everything back.
Bit of an awkward position because the Hellions are actually out on the map. The Queens are going to be dropping in here momentarily. Ravager's now being made to tear down not only the siege tank, but assist at trying to take out the wall in there at the front.
Yeah.
All right, here we go.
Oh, man. They're throwing down those Corsa Biles, immediately taking down that Liberator. And as the Queens get here, as more rallies come, I love this, all catching a bunch of Lings in the center. That's a very nice move.
Okay, he's got to be careful with his drop. The Marines can shoot that down almost instantaneously. Is he going to... Okay, he's actually going to go right for the depots. So he wants to spill in. The next target may be the bunker. Now, the Lings being dropped in here is what's going to draw some of Innovation's attention away. This has to work right now here for Leenock.
Pretty awesome moves here by Leenock, to be honest. I love the drop in the main base as well. Look at how many SCVs he's just getting to pick off. But if Innovation just breaks through here, that is a very powerful moment for him.
Yeah, this attack here by Leenock seemed pretty brainy until Innovation was like, I've got a bunch of shit, and just comes out and kills it.
But he's lost 24 SCVs during all this. Just now running his SCVs away. I guess he was focusing so heavily on the front there that he didn't realize the back.
Yeah, he might lose some more SCVs here. they were not pulled back at the same time. So it's now 27 SCVs for Innovation to the 40 drones. I thought that was going to do a little bit more damage. That was Viking barely alive.
Jeez. Two health and two kills.
Is he actually going to try to push all the way across the map?
Innovation?
Look at him. He's actually going he's
lost
crossing the middle.
SCVs that I
guess
it.
He says it's now or never. Because Leenock definitely did the damage he needed to do. I guess if you leave Leenock undisturbed, then Leenock most certainly should win the game, even against a player like Innovation. But let's see if he can make this work. Innovation's very scary with these pushes. The problem is siege tanks are not going to do well against those Ravagers if the corrosive vials are connecting. Unfortunately, we saw Leenock actually target corrosive vials on the Marines and not the tanks back there.
Definitely a bit of a mistake.
Okay, Innovation just turned that game upside down.
Yeah. Well, he had those three command centers. He was able to refill his SCVs there as well. That was very much an all-in type of maneuver from Leenock. I love the Ling drop in the main. It did a lot, but the fact that he still lost that game doesn't bode too well for him.
This is really the sign of an incredible player is when he takes such a beating, he identifies, okay, if I attack exactly now, even though the odds are against me, this is probably the only way I can win. And Leenock did not really account for that. I think most players would not have necessarily tried to push out there. They might have tried to stay back or do something a little bit more drop intensive, especially when you have roaches in the game. But he just went right for the jugular. He controlled really well. Leenock did not use the corrosive bile on the tanks when they were sieging up.
Yeah.
Usually you can corrosive bile the tanks and then run back and try to wait for some more of your army to come out and hold that. But Innovation came in there and won game one.
Well, a good save right there for him, no doubt.
Yeah.
Because that did get scary, at least for a moment. But Innovation with that very hard-to-break play. Now going on to Abyssal Reef, a map where it is very easy to get a lot of bases. How does Leenock want to play this? Will he continue with this Roach style?
Innovation's showing so far he doesn't have to do anything special to win these games. He has a standard opening. He surveys what his opponent's doing. If there's an attack coming his way, he braces for impact and then pushes out. Otherwise, he doesn't get attacked and pushes out and wins anyways. Anyways, game number two, Leenock versus Innovation.
GSL Season 1, Code S, Daybreak. When the lights come out.
In the upper left in the blue, he is.
Titan EX1. Leenock.
And in the bottom right in the red.
Innovation.
By the way, it really is packed here today. People are pretty hyped to have some StarCraft II back in their lives.
Yeah, welcome to the studio, guys. it's good to be back. We did have a long hiatus. Long break from GSLs.
Indeed.
Felt weird, actually, not coming down to the studio and doing some StarCraft II.
Yeah.
Not coming after to the a week or two, I really start to miss it. So it's good to be back.
Yeah.
And as usual, guys, by the way, I know that we have a lot of newer people that are watching since StarCraft II is free to play. So we're always on Saturdays at 1 p.m. KST. and we're also on at 6:30 p.m. on Wednesdays KST.
That's correct. Good times for Europe and for North America.
Yep. today is the good time, especially for North America.
And all the times are reasonable for Australia.
Yeah, the Australians, they got dealt a good hand, for sure, with GSL times for them.
Yeah, but then they're like, wow, I'm really pumped to play. And then they get that latency, and it's like, oh, man.
Yeah, that's true. Ooh. That's very true. It's funny because in that last game, what Leenock was doing initially was actually working for him. He just didn't seem to account for the possibility that a Terran, after taking that much of a beating and losing that many workers, would do a counter all-in. Because, guys, in that last game, if that attack by Innovation did not work, that was basically the end of the game.
You know, if he just gets smashed with that attack, it is definitely a very tough spot.
Ooh! Oh, hide! That was so close.
Yeah.
That's exactly how you cast that moment.
That was so close. He did it!
He did it! So, very fortunate that Leenock managed to get the third hatchery up there by sneaking the drone out. If that gets denied and killed, it's going to be a while before Zerg can move out and reclaim more expansions. Yeah.
Nothing too crazy going on right now. It's kind of what you would expect from Innovation, playing this very, very safe style. Hellions plus the starport. Sometimes he will go for the Hellions into a third command center. But truth be told, I think that he is playing this way just because he is very confident against Leenock. He knows that in the longer game, Leenock probably won't keep up with him. Because, like, I feel like if he's against Dark, for instance, he's going to mix in more of the quicker third command center, you know. Well Dark is maybe not the best example because he is a very aggressive player, but I'm talking about top-tier Zerg player, you know.
Well, I think when Innovation looks at this, he says, I shouldn't have to do anything too fancy. I just try to figure out what Leenock's doing, stop it, and then win the game. Which is usually what happens when you have two players that are identified as having a fair skill gap.
Yeah.
A lot of times the better player doesn't have to be fancy.
Yeah, stop what they're doing and
basically win with superior mechanics.
If they can't do what they're doing, then what are they doing? Not a whole hell of a lot.
Yeah, put that on your tombstone, Artosis. Viking now taking out the Scouting Overlord.
It's like when you grab your younger brother's like arms. Why are you hitting yourself? Why are you hitting yourself? That's what Innovation does.
Oh, okay, gets two drones. Actually getting a fair amount of links here as well.
Yeah. Pretty decent so far. Three queens, though, coming out, and you should be able to clean this up pretty easily now.
So, in this case, Innovation actually did decide to dive in and try to take out some workers, which means it's going to be a little bit easier now for Zerg to spread the creep. More conservative plays from Terrans are they do stay back and try to continue to poke and keep that creep under control. But that was a trade Innovation decided was worthwhile, is take the risk, run in, try to get workers, and then that will pay off better than trying to hold the creep. And you can see already the creep's now pushing out.
I like this Viking paving the way for a Liberator to come through. Set up a little bit. So some more harassment coming down. Roach Ward is up and he sees it, but I don't know that it's going to be that same style. His worker count is already above what he made last game. So definitely not going to be that three base all in from Leenock this time.
Right. Two queens picked off there. So nicely done.
Double Ling upgrades coming down from Leenock.
Actually, I can't say I'm too surprised with a player like Leenock. This is, he always opens up and it sort of looks standard, and then he forks from that.
Yeah. I think it's totally good. I think he'll go probably a Hydralisk Den if I had to guess here. He is getting quite a bit of gas at the moment, throwing down the Baneling Nest as well. Let's see what that tech
Hydra
choice
Bane,
is.
So Hydra perhaps.
Yeah, it's super good, and it works out very well on this map. It's kind of easy to defend everything. We shall see. Additional hatcheries going up, that fourth base being taken, and there is the Hydralisk Den. So it looks like it's going to be a more stock standard macro game out of Leenock, and I'm glad to see this out of him. I think it's a good choice, but Innovation has already started his tank production rather early here. And we'll see, because he's going bio, right? And I've always felt like against his style as Terran, if you're going bio, non-stop tank production, add your second factory, and just you have to hit before ultras, basically.
Sure.
And if you can do all those things, you can be in a very good spot. We don't know exactly how quickly he's going to go into Hive, but we'll see how Innovation pulls this one.
Now, watch carefully here as Innovation drops in, because he's one of the best players of this in the entire world, of trading effectively, and sometimes the game just snowballs. So let's see if we can have a good exchange here for Leenock. Note the angle that Innovation runs into, and at the last second picks up, losing a minimal amount of Marines. A decent amount of Lings were shaved off, and then for Innovation, it's rinse and repeat.
Yeah, and the thing is, you can't do this for too long. Once they get a sizable amount of Hydras out,
right,
they can shut down this type of play pretty quickly.
Everybody's
kill your medevac as well.
Everybody's upgrades finishing at about the same time here.
And that second factory as well is going to be finishing up. So I'm really liking where Innovation's going with this, but I'm liking where Leenock's going with it too. Jason, I just can't decide.
I just like them both so much.
Just, these guys know
they're
how to play StarCraft.
Great. I just think they're great.
I love how they both do good strategies against each other.
another drop over here, and it doesn't look like there's quite enough to defend just yet. Again, Leenock has to be very careful. There are Hydras, so Hydras can gun down the medevacs, but Innovation a little bit too quick.
Yeah, I think this is marking pretty much the end of the actual harassment. Like, he can still maybe poke some creep and stuff, but
yeah.
If he continues to fly in, I feel like he's going to be donating a lot of units. And when you're playing the style, again, what I want to see is just a big push with a lot of siege tanks. There's a lot of terrain here that you can kind of abuse against Ling Bane. So if Innovation just has a huge amount of supply and can go, he might be able to just straight up kill Leenock.
I think you're right. You can see the rate of growth for Innovation is looking pretty good. We actually have a movement down here at the bottom. Is that just Hydra Bane moving through the map?
Yeah, I believe Hydraling Bane.
He may end up hitting as Innovation is leaving. Possibly, you know, with the fourth base being taken where it is, Innovation may try to push up through the north.
Coming around, seeing if he can get some damage done here.
So his position's been revealed here now. I don't know if Leenock's actually going to commit to this. This seems a little bit overly ambitious, considering Innovation has not really moved out on the map at all at this point in time. And, you know, Hydras are not that fast when you compare how quick Marines with Stim are.
Yeah, really.
This actually may be one of the blunders of Leenock in this game. Innovation is going to come down here and swallow up the army. I don't know if we emphasize it enough, but really, although
Ooh!
Nicely done, I will say, I don't know. Innovation's very good at the whole positional play on the map.
I want to see a map on an asteroid with the same physics as this map.
Oh, yeah.
Or it's like you jump up and you're like, oh, no, there's no atmosphere or gravity. And you just like fly into space.
The Reaper tries to go uphill and it just shoots up off the map.
It's just like 100,000 years later, it finally hits the sun. Oh, man.
Unfortunately, that suit kept the Reaper alive the whole time. It was a very bad existence.
Here's maxed out Innovation with a bunch of siege tanks pushing into the fourth base here of Leenock. Leenock is taking a fifth.
I don't know if Leenock has a really good angle to try to come in here from behind. He's going to be hitting this expansion, and it is going to be an attempt here to come from behind. The siege tanks are pretty well placed out here. A large army, though, from the top. And it looks like Leenock, in fact, may have enough with all these tanks going down. Only Hydras remaining. He's going to wait for these reinforcements to come in and then try to begin the push again, only from a further back position. Supplies right now, 147 to 169. Innovation seems to be growing at a slightly better rate, although Leenock has shoved Innovation off of an area where he can actually hit the hatchery.
Yeah.
So it's very important for Leenock that that's happening.
He's bought himself a very good amount of time, but definitely needs to get a lot of Ling Bane in here. He needs one more flank on this, I believe, if he's going to hold it. If he loses this hatchery, Innovation is in a beautiful, beautiful spot.
That queen didn't even have a death animation. It just disappeared. It died like that guy at the end of Looper, man. It's whoop. once again, an attack coming in here from Leenock. The tanks are very well covered, though. Well, as I say that, actually, they're not. They're going to die over here in the far left.
They're very well covered, you say. Yes, covered with Zerglings.
Yes. One does still remain, but it seems like Innovation may have enough now to punch through. Again, that hatchery from taking a beating earlier will go down.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Innovation just relentless with this push. There's Vipers on the way now, but that is kind of slow. Obviously, they'll be really helpful when they get out, but a lot of damage has been dealt with this already. And now Ghosts even on the way.
Yeah. From here, it starts to be doubly more difficult for Leenock. He's lost that expansion, which means Innovation economically is just bigger. And as you can see, he's not stopping that rate of growth. This area is actually much easier for Terran to push in, since it's a valley in some sense. And from here, he's going to try to come in here. Those tanks, again, taking a lot of damage. But as the Marines are forked away, the Hydras have to run. And this actually may be the beginning of the end.
Yeah. It's not looking too good. Even targets down one of these Vipers, disappears as well. GG.
Nicely done. Innovation 2-0s.
Yeah. Pretty clear victory right there for our man Innovation. Leenock trying to play more of a straight-up macro game. It's kind of a short map, but generally you want to have there be like this tension of Innovation trying to hit the tank push before Ultras, right? Because if you add a couple Ultras into that type of army that Leenock has, which you would have had the money for, you know, on that many bases, then suddenly this becomes a lot harder for Innovation to kill him. But a little bit slower on that high tech that game from Leenock, unable to really find his stride in that game.
I feel for Leenock, you know, when you're playing great in a game like we saw earlier with him against Solar, he's high on life, and then you go up against Innovation, you realize, wow, it's like I'm hitting a brick wall.
Yeah.
No matter what I do, he seems to just have more. He seems to always know my position. We're going to go to an interview now with Innovation and see how he's feeling, being the first player to move on to the round of 16. Let's meet our winner, Innovation. Congratulations. Thank you. So it's the new year, it's the new season. You're the first player to advance. What are your thoughts? When I was practicing, I was actually losing a lot of games. But when I look at my group, I didn't think the players I was up against would necessarily be that hard. I thought the games went better than I expected. So, we haven't seen you in a GSL match in a while. How does it feel to be back in the studio? Oh, I didn't get nervous at all. I felt good. Yeah, it's been a while to be in an offline match. But I'm always happy to come down here and play in front of a live audience. So, when you compare your matches from the last season to, excuse me, from the last season to last year, how do you feel with how you're playing today? Well, in the games, I actually did feel that Leenock, excuse me, I could tell that Leenock was a little bit nervous in the games against me. I could feel that he wasn't very confident. So when Leenock went for that all-in in game number one, I was pretty sure that from that point on I would win the series. I want to say that Solar is looking really good recently, but since Leenock has won against him, I'm curious to see if Solar can actually get out. It seemed like last season was your season, Innovation. You were peaking in your career. You had four championship titles last year. How do you expect for 2018 to go? Honestly, if I face really strong opponents, I think I'm still capable of losing. So, I'm going to come into this new year without a greedy attitude. But I think if Terran gets patched and buffed, I think my chances will be better. Any words to your fans? So in 2018, I'm hoping, I hope for the people that are watching and to my fans, I hope every day for you is a good day in 2018. Please keep supporting me and the GSL. Congratulations once again, Innovation says thank you.
Right.
Well, this is the results we were expecting, and honestly, even the way that the games looked is not too shocking.
Yeah, I mean, Leenock tried it all in. It didn't work. He tried syrup macro play. It didn't work. Innovation is the best Terran in the world and has been for a very, very long time.
Yeah.
What can you say?
Overall, some of these games actually looking pretty similar to some of the Legacy of the Void games
saw.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And that should change over time. It's not uncommon that players will stick to what already worked in some of the previous tournaments before they start to branch out. Or we'll see if, in fact, some of these changes are as dramatic as some people were expecting. It's still very new in this new iteration of StarCraft II.
Well, I mean, I think that they both played very well as far as the strategies go on Abyssal Reef. I think that's what our TVCs this season are mostly going to look like.
All right, guys, we're going to go to a break. When we come back, we will go on to the losers match and decide who is going to be the first player to be eliminated in today's GSL Codas.
waiting as life passes me by. While I'm here looking for something I don't know if I'll ever find. I hate how this ends. Words from
아프리카 TV에는 당신이 아는 것보다 다양한 인종이 살고 있죠. 말 많은 인종, 발 빠른 인종, 잘 먹는 인종, 영리한 인종, 친절한 인종까지. 모든 게 컨텐츠가 되고 누구나 주인공이 되는 세상. 알고 보면 멋진 세상.
Are you free? Africa TV.
Dead or alive? Those are the lyrics. Well, we're going to find out who is dead or alive in just a moment, Artosis. Indeed. One of these two guys is going to be the first to be eliminated. We've already got Innovation, our first survivor.
Yeah.
I don't think it's looking good for Creator.
No.
If we're basing this off of previous players, or excuse me, player history.
If we're basing this off of anything other than who was better in 2011. I think that Creator is having a hard time here against Solar, but we will see. We will see.
I feel for Creator because he's not a bad player at all, but he doesn't...
He's very good.
Yeah, he just doesn't have anything extra in these games. He seems like he's fast,
he doesn't
he's
have
scary,
what
but he's not...
Tasteless likes to call the X Factor.
He doesn't have that X Factor.
Yeah. He's just never going to be a star.
Not if he doesn't win Artosis, unfortunately. Whereas Solar's somebody who's got really robust macro games, but he's also very tricky.
Yeah, yeah, he's a very brainy Zerg player.
He exhibits a lot of the qualities that you expect in the very, very best players in the whole world. Creator is somebody who looks really good. He is a great practice partner, according to a lot of these other pro gamers, but he does not have, as far as we can tell, any real tricks up his sleeve, any styles of play that are going to change the meta, are going to throw his opponents off. So this is going to be a tough one for Creator.
It really is. I mean, Solar is a tough cookie to crack in this matchup. He's one of the best swarm host players. He's literally the first person in the modern day to use Bane Hydra.
That's right.
He kind of reintroduced that to the meta, like way before anyone else is using it. No one even used it after him for a long time. So, I mean, he has a full range of play.
Yeah.
I feel like right now the ZBP, everyone's got like very good Hydra timings and stuff. So, Creator, I mean, we'll see. Is he just going to make a Warp Prism charge lots in Archons? Like, is that what we're going to see? Does he have something else up his sleeve? All right, let's do it.
GSL Season 1, Codex, Daybreak.
When the lights come on, when the crowd goes wild, let the roof up on the hills.
Okay, in the upper left, in the blue, he is.
Jyn Air Green Wings, Creator.
You know, I keep going through the match number in my head. It's like 3563 right now. Trying to figure out when the next satisfying pattern of numbers will be. I just keep thinking about it. And I can't come up with anything right now that's anywhere close.
Slugs, Solar.
I guess in four matches, 3, 5, 6, 7, but that's not really that good.
No, you know, not that satisfying, really.
that doesn't tickle the part of my brain I want it to tickle, you know?
an immediate Nexus here, and Protoss beginning to wall in.
Oh, Nexus first, yeah, look at that.
Yeah. I don't know if Zerg's going to try to do any Baneling busts. Those seem like they can definitely, at times, be problematic.
Yeah,
because Solar's somebody who will do an all-in.
Yeah, he'll definitely mix in. I think that he doesn't do it here. Stargates are still very popular in this matchup. And, like, you don't expect for something like that to end up working. That's not where you're going to make your money, is on Baneling Bus, in this matchup. Maybe no regret, but other people know. But, yeah, I mean, I think that Solar will just play a macro game. You know, maybe get one of these quicker layers that we've been seeing a lot out of Zergs. Get those Hydras out. Just kind of be wary of quick Adept plays. And you should be all right. I do like the fact that he went Nexus first, though. This is good stuff. Like, he's showing a little bit of speed in his play here.
It's looking a little bit more like StarCraft 1 build to start things off. Just immediately getting that Nexus up. And
where's the Forge, though?
Well, that's the beautiful part is if he doesn't have to worry about whether or not the Lings will fit through.
Yeah.
Unlike the problem for Protoss players in StarCraft 1, where 20 years later, we still don't quite know how to wall in correctly. So the third hatchery comes down, which is a completely reasonable response to a Protoss fast expanding, and Zerg wants to get that economic tempo advantage.
Yeah. Three bases after that speed. Stargate on the way, very standard on both sides. Do you expect 1 to 2 oracles coming up? And I would imagine a layer in another minute or so should get started. We'll see exactly how quickly Solar wants to do it. Definitely something I've noticed, in the current metagame, we're seeing layer a little bit quicker from Zerg players than it was a few months ago.
Okay, Link Speed nearly finished now. And the first Adept is going to come out here. It looks like these two Links might be able to get through. The Adept's not going to be done in time, and they do manage to slip in here to do a little bit of scouting.
Yeah, it's a bit annoying, especially with speed.
Yep, seeing that second gateway. Just slowing down some of the mining here. And that Adept is now going to shade in. One probe killed off. Looks like he should be able to get two here.
Wow.
Oh, wow.
Could he get three tasteless?
Let's find out. I think he will. Yeah. Nicely done. These are actually doing a lot more damage than I thought they were.
Quality.
Second group of Lings peeking in to see if they could actually run in. Did he?
Yeah. He sees that as well. That's a pretty solid scout seeing the robo. That definitely can mean that he goes for one of these plays where you see the quick prism possibly going into charge and Archons. It's pretty popular at the moment. Second Oracle is on the way. First one flying across right now, I believe, right?
I think so.
I think it's about to
hit
the third.
That should be it over there between the second and the, yeah, there it is. And behind that harass, Zerk droned up a decent amount. And we actually have the second Oracle coming out, and now it's going to be Phoenix's added in.
Yeah, the Forge plus Twilight coming up here as well. So I believe that we'll see some additional gates going up. Is he just going to take a third base right away off of this tech? I mean, that's definitely doable also.
It's definitely possible when you have Oracles out like this. It's a little bit harder for Zerg to actually come in there and shut down that Nexus once it gets started. Yeah.
I like Solar's play as well. He's going a little bit later layer than what I was talking about before, but getting the Roach Warren and getting that plus one melee. So he is really playing to stay alive against everything. Wow, that was really nice micro there.
Really nicely
good
done.
Stuff.
Now, that being said, though, these links here from Solar are attacking these Adepts. Normally, the Oracles are handy in shutting down any kind of attack on that third base. So they are eventually, that one is eventually saved here. These links trying to the Nexus. I believe these Adepts should be able to chase them away pretty easily, though.
Certainly you are right about
hold
that.
Up. Yeah. I think some of this might be dependent on whether or not Creator, he might get greedy and try to pick up those Adepts and then fly across the map, in which case maybe a lot of links come in here and do this.
Well, with a shield battery and a cannon coming up, should be completely fine here.
No, I think you're probably correct about that, actually. It makes a huge difference.
Yeah, the Ling's still roaming a little bit here. This is kind of cool, though. Look at this. He's making a single Roach right now, and he's getting a Baneling Nest to go with this, right? So once upon a time, the meta of ZVP was Roach, Ravager, Baneling. That was a strong composition for a bit. People eventually figured out how to stop it. You know, Archons and Immortals, I guess, are pretty good against those units. But, oh my god, I was segueing into this is cool, though, because he's making a Spire. The low gas cost of Roaches can get into a Spire very easily. But I believe he canceled that Spire and has gone into a Hydralis Den, which is much more normal, much more what you would expect.
I'm curious if he showed a Spire when he was being scouted and then canceled it.
That could be it.
We didn't really get a lot of shots of, you know, what scouted what, especially on the Zerg side of the map. Now, this War Prism, just like it has been used in Legacy, is basically there to pin the Zerg inside of his base. Zerg can't really dominate the map too much.
Oh, okay, my
this
God.
Is gonna work out. Oh, no. Actually, okay,
still
that still
awesome.
Got a lot.
Still awesome.
Had he done that like a half second earlier pull away, it would have been nowhere near impact. Oh, my God, he's going to do it again!
Okay, well, that one wasn't as good. May as well call him Sular.
So, this War Prism, he wants to just make sure that the Zerg is honest with how much he can move out on the map. If the Zerg sends everything out, the War Prism's going to come in here and begin a mass warp in. Although, I don't feel like Solar's actually that worried about it. But he'll be staying back, I think, for the time being and just teching up.
Well, this is the whole game right now is shifting. He can't attack. Like, the Creator cannot attack at this moment. The best he can do is a little bit of harassment. And, in fact, he needs to have a Prism set up somewhere. Does he have a Prism on the map? I'm looking at my tiny little mini-map. Is that a Prism at the top right? I'm not sure.
It might be
the Phoenix or an Oracle, though.
It might be the Oracle, actually. The one that was shooting the stasis
prism,
wards.
Yeah. I think you're right.
I think the only Prism that's out on the map. Ooh. Yeah, there it is now. God, this...
He's done very well with his Oracles.
He's got a lot of kills with that. The Prism, I think, is still rotating around in the bottom. There it is now.
Okay.
Just sort of waiting as Protoss tries to build up.
Yeah, that's super important, right? Because we're hitting right in that area where you have your Hydralisks upgraded. You have Baneling speed as well. You generally get both those by 8 minutes. And at that point, it's like Protoss cannot attack you. Protoss must play on defense for a little bit, weather any attacks that you're going to do. And one of the best things that they can do during this time is some harassment with a Warp Prism. So we'll see if he can get that Prism in there and get something done.
Solar now takes a fifth expansion, and this is really where Zerg can start to get a lot of momentum. Protoss trying to sneak out here. And I think you're totally right, Artosis. Protoss tends to, at times, have to be a little bit defensive here. A push from Protoss, it's not impossible, but it's quite ambitious if they try to do that.
The thing is, if you're trying to attack in against this, it It, like, Psystorm is better defensively, and if you're trying to attack in when you have Zealots against Hydra Bane, it's a very tough time unless you already have some sort of edge going on. So little moves like this are fantastic, though. Look at this, a little Zealot run-in. You know, it, maybe this will do something, maybe it won't. This time, not really, but it keeps him back. Notice how Solar hasn't been able to attack at all, which might be his plan anyways, of course. Like, if you're playing a very good Protoss that's just sitting there defending, the best thing you can do is sit back and tech up.
Okay, that definitely did not do as much damage as Solar had hoped coming up here. Solar, by the way, moments away from actually maxing now. Do you think he's going to try to dive in on that fourth base that Creator's taking? We're at a point in time where I think it's completely reasonable that all Zerg has to do is keep smashing the fourth base and never letting Protoss get any bigger. And as long as he's holding Harass like this, he's basically fine.
Yeah, I think if he keeps pressure on but does not sacrifice a huge chunk of army, this is the best play. Because, like, the follow-up, when like the composition that Creator's making can deal with Hydraling Bane, but it can't deal with Broodlords. And we see that he's on the path of Broodlord tech. He's just started the Spire and the Hive at the same time, so that links up perfectly. You get your Greater Spire as quickly as possible. So, like, I feel like just keeping pressure on, trying to keep him off of Tempest is the best thing you can do. But look, Creator's on top of this as well. Fleet Beacon is going down in enough time to get Tempest out in time for Broodlord. So, like, this game so far, both these guys have played just excellently, I feel. This is kind of the beautiful thing that in StarCraft 2, where it's like, strategically, they're going tit for tat. They're just like, okay, now I tech to this, now I tech to this. And you see these little subtle movements where neither player right now really feels like they can commit to a full attack.
Well, it seems like, actually, Solar wants to try to come in here from two different sides. Yeah. You know, Archons and Immortals are not fast. Therefore, if you're in the wrong location, you're not going to be able to do that much. So he's actually going to pull some of his army out here now. Now, these Storms doing a lot of damage, and it seems like, actually, Creator split his army up basically perfectly. So Solar overextending a little bit. Again, whenever you see Hydras attacking anywhere, if the Zerg starts to lose the attack, the Zerg's probably also going to lose all the Hydras as they try to run away. Yeah. Pretty much everything Protoss can catch up to him.
It seems like he didn't, like, super-duper overcommit there, which is quite nice. And he's got 2-1 upgrades on these Lings, which is super fantastic, dealing with that Zealot harassment well. But look, I mean, I think that Creator's defense so far has been really great. Like, that recall was super nice to make sure he didn't take any damage over there. Just as long, and look, we're hiding that production tab, so we don't know. Is he making Tempest right now? Because he needs some Tempest right now.
We also want to keep our eyes on this Protoss army that we have on camera right now, especially the Immortal count. If he loses all those Immortals, it's going to take a long time to rebuild back up. He has 10 Immortals in this game right now. Even though Creator's done a great job holding on, we have yet to see him actually push out and do some damage of his own. And it seems like that point in time is going to be now. He's beginning to edge out here.
It's a super scary army.
Yeah, it's something that Solar's going to have to respect for sure. And it's definitely one that's not easy to engage into.
Yeah.
Okay, so he's now in Zerg turf. Force fields are coming out here. And it's going to be very important that Solar takes his time and does not overextend with this. We see some Banelings coming around. Oh, there's an Archon up here to try to deny this. Great Storms down there at the third base.
Yeah, truly awesome Storms going down all over these Hydralisks. The Immortals dealing huge amounts of damage. Another great Psy Storm over to the side there.
I think he might actually have too much. Zerg's remaking everything, but this is in the center of where all the hatcheries are, so the rally points are going to be pretty ugly.
Well, yeah, this base should fall, but he has Broodlords on the way. And Broodlords, with just a little bit of ground army, can clear this out reasonably well. I love that he's gone into Stalkers, but his Blink is only halfway done.
That's true. I don't know where the Broodlords are exact. Okay, I guess they're just below our screen. That answers that.
He says while the Broodlords are there.
Here we go. So they're going to come up. So it's up to the Protoss to try to avoid actually being around the Broodlords. Now, the Broodlord in groups is a bit of a double-edged sword because a lot of times the Protoss can't engage it, but the Protoss with Stalker specifically can always go around it.
Yes.
You can always blink into the main or anywhere else, and the Broodlords are not going to be able to get there in time.
That is quite true. You know, the Stalker definitely has gotten some changes that have made it a stronger unit, and like just kind of running around Broodlords is one way to do it. The thing is, if it's a full-on engagement and there's a decent amount of units underneath, it's very hard to blink underneath Broodlords.
By the way, I want to point out, there's this expansion right here. This is so ambitious with Broodlords in the game. to expand just right towards the Zerg.
Yeah.
It is 194 supply to 122. There are Banelings underneath there, but I'm wondering if the sheer amount of Sockers that's going to be a GG.
Well done.
Creator wins game number one.
You know, I thought he was going to have to go into Tempest. I really did because of the speed of that Broodlord tech, but he just pulled the trigger right before those Broods. Like, if those Broods had been there, 45 seconds earlier, if they had been with the Lingbane Hydra before Creator wrecked it, easy hold, easy big lead for Solar there. But Creator hit a super sharp timing right there. Very well done.
Look at Creator right now. Had his head down, really getting focused, saying, okay, this is a possibility. Solar, by the way, he was supposed to be out of this group second place easy. He's already lost to Leenock. He's now in the losers. And I think it's fair to say we would all expect Creator to have an even harder time against Solar.
Dude, based on that game, he can beat Solar and Leenock.
Yeah.
Based on that game, he can get second place in this group.
Well,
absolutely.
His PVZ seems fine, and right now, that's all that
matters.
That
was a great game. That was very well played by him. Like, especially that timing before the Broodlords, that's hard to hit, and he nailed it.
Okay. Game number two is going to be on the map Odyssey. Let's see what happens. The pressure's on for Solar. So far, 2018 is not looking to be his year. He may be the first player to be knocked out of the GSL Codex, which is really weird to say. Leenock or Creator was, I think, what everybody was expecting to hear as far as who was eliminated first. But this is a very big upset if Creator manages to win either this game or the next. And our game is now loaded up, so let's do this. Game number two on the map Odyssey.
GSL Season 1, Codex Daybreak. When the lights come out.
In the bottom right, winning game number one, he is
Jyn Air Greenwings, Creator.
And in the upper left, in the red, our Zerg player.
Splice, Solar.
Super cool so far. Really enjoyed that first game so much. But, based off that first game, it seems like they're a very good match for each other in this matchup. I do notice that Odyssey was Solar's map choice. That was kind of the map he wanted to play on here. The Lingbane Hydra attacks that you can do on this map are a little bit hard to defend sometimes for Protoss. You know, the third base, you're generally going to take the one below your natural, or I guess in this case above, for Creator. I always spawn on the left side, so that's why I get confused. But it's a little bit hard in that area. You don't have a lot of room for microing or buildings there. But I'll be interested to see, because last time, like, he got into it, right? His Baneling speed didn't finish till about 810. But he didn't do a full attack. He harassed a little. He did one little attack, but it wasn't like a big deal, you know? Convince my wife to watch with me all the way to the Philippines.
Welcome, guys. Excellent. Thanks for coming down. I have to say, I'm a little bit surprised we didn't have any crazy cheeses, especially considering that the whole game has been changed. A lot of times that's when an all-in or something like that can be the scariest, is when people really just don't have any experience with it. But instead, most of today's games have been very textbook RTS, very proper. This is the way you want to play if you want to ladder up and have consistent wins.
People have been pretty active, so I think that, you know, a lot of those cheeses have been kind of figured out. We're not, unless Hass is playing, we're not seeing the proxy 18 shield battery attacks or, you know, stuff like that as much right now. So, okay, quick Twilight this game. So showing a bit more variety here is Creator. Not a bad choice, but specifically Solar in the previous game, we did see him add a Roach Warren early on. Some Zergs will downright skip that. But if you have a Roach Warren, there's not a lot to fear from this early Twilight tech. So if basically what I'm trying to say is, like, there's two types of Zergs in this world. Ones that'll make a safety Warren and ones that won't.
Yeah.
Solar's one that will.
Yeah, well, I feel like even though Solar has not been performing very well today, he's a player who definitely probably views himself as generally better than his opponent and therefore just needs to make sure everything is safe in the early game, and he should be able to win later on. And that would make sense in why he's doing that. Now, we have Zealot Legs coming here, yeah, along with the Robo.
And he got in, and he actually scouted exactly what was going on. So will, yeah, we see him throw down a Roach Warren momentarily here? He saw the Robo. He saw the Twilight making an upgrade. It's pretty easy to figure out what's going on.
It would seem like this, yeah, would be the exact response, yeah, you would want to have. And even getting one Overlord to come in there now, just to get confirmation of that.
Totally. And with the Roach Warren on the way, it makes me a bit nervous here for Creator. You know, he's going to be sitting here playing with charge lots. And this is like, don't bring charge lots to a Roach fight, man.
Well, I mean, the Zealots aren't going to do anything.
In the early game, it's like later game, yeah, fine. You have enough production and stuff. You got some upgrades going on. But in this early portion where you're warping in charge lots off like four gates, and you're trying to kill a three-hatch Zerg with three queens that's making roaches and lings and has their queens out, I don't see this work. It's in my opinion, this is a tough one. But I do like these the Templar Archives follow-up. That's nice. When you force things like roaches out to kind of go into that, you can do some harassment. They don't have Hydras to shoot down your Prism so easily. That can be nice.
Yeah, well, I think also he's teched in this direction, but I think identifying that you really can't do that much, what other choice do you have than to tech past this? Yeah. They go to another phase of the game where you might have some options. So the War Prism's moving out. Now, I almost feel like this is more as the idea of the threat than the actual, than it actually doing any damage. It's going to keep, like we saw thematically in the last game, it's going to keep Zerg pretty honest. You know, and I think this will also just allow Creator to comfortably take a third. And let's remember that in the last game, oh no, two more Lings actually getting in. How about that? Okay.
Cool.
Basically, the entire game, Solar's seen everything the Creator's doing from start to finish.
Yeah. And, you know, it can be useful just to force roaches out of your opponent, right? Because roaches are much easier to counter. But
sure,
with roach speed on the way and a lot of roaches being made, he might be going for an old school counter to Archon drop. Because this is an Archon drop coming. And the first build that started countering this was people that would just make a bunch of speed roaches and attack the third base. And you would just see the Protoss lose the third base like every time.
Yeah.
And so Archon drop went away for a little bit. Eventually it came back. Yeah, it's a usable build still. But let's see where he wants to go with this, because there's double Prism out, a bunch of speed charge lots coming down here to the third.
Okay, so the Archon's going to do so much damage. It can be micro to such an insane extent if you're good at juggling them in and out of the War Prism. But the Zealots alone aren't going to be able to do that much. Here come the Archons now. A note he wants to pick up immediately and go back and just find another area where he can do damage while basically not losing anything, as long as he doesn't lose the Archons, because if it's just shields, they're always going to come back.
Yeah.
He's doing a lot of damage to his opponent. Of course, he has to be careful. If he loses that War Prism, then it's all for nothing. So Solar's going to be looking for that, yeah, especially in areas on creep to try to gun that down.
Well, anything he can get. This is like,
oh!
This is a cool thing about Archon drop against, you know, these roach-based plays, right?
Yeah.
It's just pure value. He's killed, like, an Overlord, a couple drones. Maybe he'll get a roach. He's got some lings, you know.
And this Zerg army's not moving out on the map. It's not going to try to fight the third or anything like that. But look at this. He just continues to rotate them in and out. And right when they get low, he backs out.
Great stuff.
Uh-oh.
Well, there is that counterattack.
Now let's see what there actually is. There's a few Zealots here, which might as well be nothing there at all.
Must have units. Yeah, there it
okay.
is.
Okay, it's got something. One Immortal. Angling's going to be a little bit awkward here. Force field comes down but does not lock any roaches out.
That was an instant bile, too, on that force field. So really nicely done by Solar.
Okay.
Look at him just chew through this, man.
Yeah.
This is what originally ended Archon drops.
Yeah. Well, there's just so much here. And the force fields aren't really doing anything. Now he's going to tear through. We see that the Archons are dropping back over here. I don't know, though. I think that Zerg can continue to pump out units. And
is he going to break through?
I think so. I mean, it's just there are two Immortals, and that's really what's going to help fight the roaches.
Yeah.
But there's really nothing else to stop those Immortals from taking damage here.
Well, he's got the Prism Juggle going on a little bit here. He's got to pick up that one. Ah, it's so low, that red Immortal.
I can't believe that's still alive. He even dropped it in the front.
That's the last thing they'll expect.
Yeah.
Right in front of them.
That should be game. There's not even enough room to really warp in here without dodging Biles. So that should be GG, and we'll actually go to our first game 3 here of the season of the GSL Code S. there's really nothing. Yeah, there's nothing that you can do to stop this from coming through. Zerg will be able to get in the main, take out all the tech. The last immortal goes down.
Well,
I don't know if you guys really want me to play-by-play this anymore. Building's blowing up.
I don't.
24 dead probes.
Oh,
man, that's too bad.
Heartbreaking.
GG. So, Solar evens it up.
So, let me just say something about that, right? If you're going to do double prism harassment, again, this is one of the original counters that was used against that. And the counter to the counter that people found, like, for instance, Zest started doing Archon drops again, right? And what he would do is, if you were going to counterattack him, he would kill one of your bases.
Yeah.
He's like, I will sack my third possibly here, right? But I'm going to kill one of your bases. And, like, basically, Creator saw the attack coming, and he's like, uh-oh, I better go home with these Archons to save it. And I think he was right. They had, like, no shields and stuff. But, I mean, damn, if you're sitting there making charge lots that aren't doing any damage, you're not making Immortals at home, you have one Immortal when 25 Speed Roaches come, you're in trouble.
Well, also, I feel like that strategy, I'm surprised Creator even thought that was going to work against somebody like Solar. Solar, on some level, built his career off shutting stuff like that down with just really robust play and coming out and just having more in the end. Mm. And I think something, I guess, as fancy as that, and also that's been tried and tested, that's not a new strategy. That's actually pretty dated. That's, I don't think, just going to work at all. I think, in fact, Creator wants to probably dial it back to a more normal play of just defending, just being safe.
I love this play on Ascension Ire.
And yeah, you know, I thought it was awesome.
I like that he tried to mix it up. It just absolutely didn't work out for him there on Odyssey.
Sure. Well, you got to try different strats in a series like this. Unfortunately, that one didn't work.
GSL Season 1.
Let's go to this last game.
Codas, Daybreak. When the lights come out.
Our Protoss player in the upper right.
Jyn'Air Greenwings, Creator.
And his opponent down here in the bottom left.
Splunts.
So we're on black pink, okay? What would you rather have, a black eye or a pink eye?
That's a tough one.
That is a tough
one. Is pink eye the correct answer? I'm not totally sure.
Well,
black eye,
you know,
would have to mean I got
beat
up.
Right?
Yes, I know what pink eye is or does.
Well, okay, I'm just making sure.
Yeah, no problem.
But no, a black eye doesn't mean necessarily you're beat up. Maybe you walked into a door. I don't know.
That's true. Maybe you fell.
Yeah, could be.
Oh, nice.
Oh, this guy has a flask.
That's excellent.
He's got a.
That's
not only
exactly
does he have a GSL hoodie, but he's like swigging from a flask in the back
so
of the studio
excellent.
Watching
well,
some
ZBP. That's how StarCraft was meant to be watched,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. Oh, man. I love it. You don't see flasks enough nowadays.
I know.
Cheers to that
guy. We need
guy.
To bring flasks back.
Yeah.
So, in this game, everything pretty normal, actually. Again, I thought maybe we'd see something crazy so far today. We still have one more series after this, by the way, guys. Don't forget, the winner is going up against Leenock. Leenock, who actually managed to defeat Solar earlier today here. And I think it was a pretty impressive upset.
Yeah.
2-0.
Yeah, and I don't think he played terribly against Innovation. It's just,
no.
It's Innovation. What do you want? But right now, I'm looking at this. All three of these players, I give a very good shot of getting out. Like, you know, I can't actually decide the favorite. Looking at the games that we've seen already today, Creator has shown very good PvZ. Leenock has shown very good ZvZ. So this is not just a Solar walkover, which coming into today, I have to be frank, I really thought that Solar.
Oop.
I was like, okay, Leenock could upset him, but that's about it.
Nicely done. Gets the pylon down there. So the hatch can't be planted just yet. And there's just not quite enough to get it fast enough. There he goes. Gets that cancel. But that, you know, that buys a few extra seconds. Now the Adept is going to come out. Ling's actually going to pass this by. I thought he was actually going to keep pursuing. These Lings are probably going to try to come up here and get inside the natural. Solar's overall been pretty good about doing that.
Ling's been getting in his base all day long.
If you remember in game two, Solar basically had vision the entire time of Protoss's base.
Pretty
from start to
thing
finish.
To have, really. Well, it's a Robo coming up, so it might be the same type of build. It could be an Adept all in as well, considering he's made three Adepts so far. It's a possibility. Still definitely a doable build, of course.
Okay, some nice harass coming in here. And he's going to get behind these minerals to try to buy time and then try to shade away.
You know what? This might be one of those...
To be honest, guys, this is getting four drones.
Seriously.
I mean, that's pretty good. Although, once again, Solar here with the scouting. He sees exactly what's going on.
Huh. Okay, so a robo with a prism. And he's making sentries out of his gateway. So this is kind of interesting. Like, there are some sentry stalker, like, mass up all-ins that you can do, or you hit that third base and you kill them before they get their hydras out.
Is he going to pull this up? Oh,
my God.
It did not quite work.
Greediest thing I've ever seen my whole entire life.
Okay, so the Ling's actually run in. He was trying to shade behind and then build a pylon in front of the Adept, so when the shade finished, it would be behind, but it wasn't quite timed out well.
Yeah, everything went wrong right there.
Now we got the sentry falling around with its Ghostbusters laser. It's doing, like, no damage at all.
Oh, my God. Dude, oh, my God, a Ghostbusters laser. I love it.
Doesn't really do that much damage.
Just holds him still.
Yeah. They got to kick the
Egon
vault.
Egon the vault!
Yeah. It was the vault, right? That's what they kicked out to catch them all.
Of course, yeah.
Remember there was a Ghostbusters cartoon, but for some reason they were friends with Slimer?
Yeah. But that was awesome.
Yeah, well, no, but I mean, in the movie, Slimer got messed up. He was the first guy to go down.
Oh, no, he got screwed,
He was the
man.
First boss in the movie.
Well.
The first boss!
Don't screw around in a library, man.
You got to really think about it, actually, in that Ghostbusters cartoon. What was going on Slimer's head betraying all ghosts?
You know what's too bad?
It's like a ghost sociopath?
Yeah, kind of.
Yeah.
He was like the Jar Jar Binks of that, though. But, like, truthfully, you know what's funny is poor Slimer is in that vault right now in the Ghostbuster movie canon world, and he's just been stuck there, which is basically ghost hell forever, right?
Yeah. That's now, like ghost solitary confinement.
If he had just waited to haunt that library just a few more years when the internet came out, no one ever would have even known he was in there.
That's true.
No one would have gone to that library, all right?
That's a very good point, Artosis.
I guess the only people that would know are the same people who won't tell you because they're like the guys that go to the library to look at porn or something. You know? Those guys aren't telling on no ghosts, dude.
That's right.
It's not happening.
It's between me and the ghosts. All right.
The ghost sees what he's looking at. He's like, I won't tell if you won't.
Ghosts do not tell.
What happens, the library stays in the library.
Slimer's like, just don't tell him I'm taking food in the kitchen. Even though it's a library and there is no kitchen.
I know.
Okay, here we go. The push is actually coming out. Actually, is he going to just back out?
This is not really the scariest army I've ever seen.
What exactly is this dancing hologram lady doing on this map? And ninja vanish.
Where'd they go?
Oh, there they are. Oh, I was confused.
Look, it didn't work!
What power is that by the Zerg? Oh, okay, he escaped.
So there's actually mutas on the way.
Yep.
And there haven't been Stargates. There's no blink. This is mutas are a pretty good counter against someone who doesn't have anti-air. Believe it or not, guys. Double Stargate on the way to try to counter that. But he's going to put a ton of money into Phoenixes and then have less ground units because of that. Kind of
seems like Zerg's taking this game into a really healthy direction for him.
Yeah.
Once again, as consistent with this entire series, every time Solar gets in here, Sling's like, I can't believe I'm doing this.
I got it, boss.
Okay. The mutas are out. We don't see... I'm sorry, the Warp Prism's back at home, right? It's not out on the map. I don't see it anywhere.
Oh, I don't know where it is, actually.
I have lost it. It's probably dead. It was probably died on camera. We were talking about Ghostbusters.
Sounds like
to me. It sounds like our casting. So the mutas fly back out.
It's like he never even made a prism, guys. You don't even know what game this is.
Like, this is a TVT. This is a Terran vs. Terran, yes.
At least we both knew it would be a TVT would be the least likely game to see a prism in.
So, with the mutas out, it's really the Zerg that gets to control the map now. And I don't think Protoss can actually get a fourth base for some time.
Okay, so I need to point out, he went double Stargate, made two Phoenixes, and then went blank and just stopped making Phoenixes. So that's kind of different and interesting for me. Well, I guess there's Corruptors coming. So the double Stargate and the fact that he's shown Phoenixes maybe have made Solar think that he can go Corruptor Phoenix, or Corruptor Muta against Phoenixes, which definitely is something that can be done, especially when your opponent's going Colossus.
Mm-hmm.
But Blink is going to be pretty good against all that.
Yeah, I would agree with that. You hide the Corruptors, right, when you're doing this? You keep them back, or does it actually matter?
When you have your good number, you can just go out, and you just keep them in between your the Phoenixes and your Muse. But because there's Colossus out there, they're going to be very useful for that as well.
Okay. For the time being, Protoss still turtled up on three bases. I'm sorry. No, he just now took a fourth.
Yeah.
And the Temple Archives is also just now starting. But Zerg's about to be on five bases. Zerg is also about to max out, which means there is a very high chance of a fight down here at this lower base for Protoss. And sometimes in moments like this, it's really not up to the Zerg player to try to wipe out the entire everything that's Protoss on the map. It's just to keep shutting down that fourth base.
Mm.
And then eventually the Protoss dries up economically. Mm. So this is really the burden right now really on Creator to try to push out. And you can see already zoning-wise, it looks like almost as if Solar's going to let this Nexus probably finish before he goes down here, and instead he's going to try to see if he can't take a big fight up here in the front.
Oh, God. That is a lot of Banelings.
Yeah. Oh, my God.
That is a serious amount of Banelings. And then the Force Fields were not enough.
It's like one of those zombie
apocalypse.
And
then they were not enough again. Oh, my God. Over and over, they were not enough.
Well, there's a lot of Immortals over here. The Stalkers are actually pretty well placed. That might have been a little bit of an overextension. I believe the Nexus is... Yeah, the Nexus is just now finished.
I don't like the unit set, though, of Creator. Like, this is...
Yeah.
It's a good idea to get in here and harass some. Oh, he doesn't even have charge yet. Oh, my God. There's so many links. Oh, my God. I don't like his unit set. What's his unit set right now? Blink, Stalkers, and two Immortals? That's, like, his army? Are we 10 minutes into a PvZ or are we not? Like, that is not an army that does anything at this point. So, a little bit frightening in that way. He just started his Storm. Because there's Corruptors out, he's not even going to bother making another Colossus. I guess he is. Never mind.
This is actually a little bit ambitious that Protoss is moving out on the map with these Stalkers. Even though Stalkers are quite strong right now, the sheer number of Zerg units that are out and the speed at which you can move them around, you're definitely at risk of still losing those. Once again, Solar's about to hit the max out point, in which case he almost wants to get rid of some of the supply in a big attack. But remember, Solar did not actually try to attack that fourth base. He tried to attack the army. So that third base is still up and running, and now there's a fifth base being taken. Creator might, because he was a little bit more patient and defensive. Hold on, let's see how
his storm isn't done, so.
Oh my God, you're right.
That's
it
a pretty big issue.
Well, look at this. I think even if most of the Banelings hit the Immortals, he's still okay.
God. Look at how many
Banelings
he just
keeps moving Banelings until there's nothing else on the map to move into.
Whoa!
He's going to move those Banelings and blow them up on the Assimilators. It doesn't matter.
Just hits X on him in the middle of the map.
He's blowing him up on destructible rocks.
God.
Well, you know what? I don't think Solar actually saw that bottom right base. I don't think it's going to matter in the long run in this game.
No. He's still in that same situation where he doesn't really have an army that makes any sense. So he made Psystorm and a bunch of High Templars, lost the High Templars before Psystorm was done, and now he's starting Colossus production now that he has Psystorm.
Yeah. Never enough. I mean, when you're on five bases of Zerg, the amount of gas you have, I mean, you just basically roll in a nuclear bomb amount of Banelings, and there's just not much they can do. I mean, there's Banelings basically soaking damage, so the ones in the back can do damage.
Banelings as tanks.
Yeah. These Banelings in the front tank for the ones in the back. Look at this.
Oh, my God. It's a lot.
Look at this poor Colossus. Oh! Now, again, I don't think these are the most efficient trades here. I'm not sure it's going to matter.
You know what? The one completely standard game that we had from Creator, I think, was by far his best game today. Like, by far his best game.
You mean the first game he had against Solar?
Yes.
Yeah, that was a...
Like, he played a very good, solid macro game. And then he kind of did two aggressive builds in these next two games, and Solar is just like, I make Roach Warrants, you know? Maybe you want to do this against Bill, who won't make a Roach Warrant. When that's a win condition, is make a Roach Warrant. Bill's like, nah, I can do it with Hyges, it's fine. But not Solar.
Look at this. That's not going to get you a win.
Ooh,
hit the mind games.
Get wrecked.
I knew you'd do that.
These two Phoenixes are starting to come back.
Yeah. If he could just do that a couple more times. I need him to make one more Ravager, look, so he hits this one again.
Dude, he lost his Colossus. Thermalance just finished. He made two more High Templars. This is like... this is a very funny thing that I'm watching. Like, as his upgrades finish, he doesn't have the unit that uses it, and he makes the other unit. Oh, I guess he made a second Colossus. Okay.
Well, for Solar, it's just rinse and repeat. He just remakes all of these Balings, comes again in here, and tries to swallow up the remaining army. And it's getting smaller and smaller each time. The distance in supply is getting further away from each other. And I mean, what, we have like three Stalkers here. All right, that's it, GG. Solar wins, and that means he gets his rematch against Leenock.
Yeah, Creator pretty crushed there.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, he has had a string of bad years, and this one not starting any better, really. 1-4 out of Codes in the first day. Ouch.
Yep, Creator, our first player to die in the GSL for the season. And now we just have two left in Group A. The rematch, ZDZ, and I gotta say, I feel for Creator here. You know, he's been playing since day one of the beta. He's had periods where he looked like he might advance further, but was eventually outmaneuvered by some of these guys that we talk about more nowadays. He gave it his all. He had a great game against Solar in game one, but of course, that's why we have a series. Yep. Is so that the players can try different strategies, try to get reads on each other. And once again, he's out. I hope to see him again in the next season. We are going to be going to a break very shortly here. It's going to be Leenock versus Solar, so don't go away. We'll be back soon.
Cross my heart, hope to die. To my lover, I'd never lie. Said be true, I swear I'll try. In the end, it's him and I. He's got his head, I'm on my mind. We got that love, the crazy kind. I am his, and he is mine. In the end, it's him and I.
My 65 speeding up the PCH, a hell of a ride. They don't want to see us make it, they just want to divide. 2017, Bonnie and Clyde. Wouldn't see the point of living on if one of us died. Yeah. Got that kind of style everybody try to rip off. YSL dress under when she take the mink off. Silk on her body, pull it down and watch it slip off. Ever catch me cheating, she would try to cut my... Crazy, but I love her, I could never run from her. Hit it, no rubber, never would, no one touch her. Swear we drive each other mad, she be so stubborn. But what the fuck is love with no pain, no suffer? Incense, this shit, it gets dense. She knows when I'm out, I feel like she could just sense. If I had $1 million, it was down to 10 cents. She'd be down for whatever, never gotta convince. You know?
Hope to die to my lover, I'd never lie. Swear be true, I swear I'll try. In the end, it's him and I. He's got his head, I'm on my mind. We got that love, the crazy kind. I am his, and he is mine. In the end, it's him and I. Him and I.
Mobbing to the end of time. Only one who gets me, I'm a crazy fucking Gemini. Remember this for when I die. Everybody dressed in all black suits in a tie. My funeral be lit if I ever go down or get caught or they identify. My bitch was the most solid, nothing to solidify. She would never cheat, you never see her with a different guy. Ever tell you different, then it's a lie. See, that's my down bitch. See, that's my soldier. She keep that thing thing. If anyone goes there, the comment collected. She keeps her composure and she gon' ride for me until this thing over. We do drugs together, fuck up clubs together, and we both go crazy if we was to sever. You know, we keep mobbing, it's just me and my bitch. Fuck the world, we just gon' keep getting rich, you know.
Cross my heart, hope to die. To my lover, I'd never lie. Said be true, I swear I'll try. In the end, it's him and I. He's got his head, I'm on my mind. We got that love, the crazy kind. I am his, and he is mine. In the end, it's him and I.
Him and I. 아프리카 TV에는 당신이 아는 것보다 다양한 인종이 살고 있죠. 말 많은 인종, 발 빠른 인종, 잘 먹는 인종, 영리한 인종, 친절한 인종까지. 모든 게 컨텐츠가 되고 누구나 주인공이 되는 세상. 알고 보면 멋진 세상.
Are you free? Africa TV.
You know, Tasteless, I saw that, like, kind of our theme is for this year, it looks like, GSL Season 1, Daybreak. I'm like, okay, that makes sense. That's cool. Like, Daybreak. Yeah, it's like the start of the year. I can imagine our last GSL, Dusk, right?
Sure.
But then I think about GSL Season 2, right? Which we'll call from now on the Gumiho season. Now, like this season, what are we going to call it? Lunchtime.
I know. Happy hour. So. Excuse me. Leenock is, he actually could take this. He already took out Solar before. This is the revenge match. Leenock wowed us with a 2-0 victory back there. Of course, Solar is the player I think everybody was expecting before our game started to easily move on.
Yeah.
To the round of, to the round of 16 as our second player to survive. The question is, does Leenock have enough ZBZ strats
is he strong enough overall to beat Solar a second time? Generally, if you have two players and they keep playing and one is clearly better, even if it starts out even, it tends to lean more towards the better player later on, yeah, until eventually they don't really ever lose. Is that the case here? Or has Leenock actually upgraded his skill to a level where we have to re-identify where we think of him in the pantheon of good Zerg players?
Well, he's got some great micro on him. I think he's going to be aggressive. Solar's going to have to try to hold
season
on.
One, Code S, Daybreak. When the lights come out.
In the upper right, in the upper right, in the blue, he is
Titan EX1, Leenock.
In the bottom light, the bottom left, excuse me, in the red, he is
Splice, Solar.
Whoa, check it out. What? He took a base over here.
I'm like, wait, is that the defensive base or the aggressive base? So, I'd call that the aggressive base.
Okay.
now it's a defensive base. Look at this. He's hiding everything. Double hatch before pull, and it's going to work out for him, too. I love
this.
That's right. Leenock plays a completely aggressive series, and now here he is backing it up. Double hatch before pull. He knows that Solar is more likely, with his life on the line.
Right.
He's got these big sponsors to impress. You know, he's got all this fan hype to live up to. Tasosa said he's going to do well. So I'm looking at your phone. Look at the screen.
Maybe he's reading the Twitch chat.
Definitely stop that.
Yeah.
But look, I think he's really chosen a great time to play a very greedy style in this game, and it's going to throw Solar off for game two as well, whether he wins or loses.
You know, something else I do want to point out is that this is how you actually manage to continue to move on in GSLs. You don't have just one way of playing. He's aware that some of his information. Oh, there's a little bit. Maybe think someone just spilled their oatmeal there.
Like, well, that's weird.
But, you know, if you have to be able to mix it up. If you show them one thing, you can treat that as a red herring, you know, in that first series, and then completely deviate, assuming that you're good at all different styles.
Yeah.
Now, I'm imagining that Solar immediately noticed.
Yeah.
That little blip on the mini-map of the creep there.
Solar was making a spine. Okay, he just noticed now, because he was making a spine. With the timing of that second hatchery, that's like what Leenock was going for, to mess him up a little bit there. Oh, come on. What are you doing, Leenock? Oh, man. Don't just lose three drones to this. Okay, good job. Good job.
Okay. No casualties there. He's now back to mining.
Imagine if those two Lings had killed those drones, man. Just
all
like,
three.
Okay,
then
guys,
they get out.
I'm going home. We're just having innovation move on today. He did trick Solar. Solar thought for a moment that this was going to be super aggressive. And it looks like he's going straight into lair here with a spine even, realizing that there is the possibility Leenock gets hyper-aggressive.
Yeah, just because you see three bases does not mean that they have to go for econ play either.
I think it might be... Well, I guess there's two big things this could be, right? Roach speed plus one.
Okay.
Or this could be a Nidus play as well out of Solar, but because he's getting two Evos, I kind of feel like it's going to just be upgrade your Roaches and get that speed upgrade and kind of play that style.
Another cancel there.
Yeah.
And basically Solar's completely walled in now with the two Queens bunched up there. Now, a lot of times you see those two Evo chambers, that telegraphs a lot. You know, you're saying,
Certainly. Okay, I clearly don't...
I'm walling in because if I didn't and you attacked me, I'd be dead. So I'm teching up to something.
Yeah.
And, of course, the two Evo chambers does tell you a lot as well. Like, wait, what?
Oh, my God.
Oh, my God.
It's actually...
Guys, get a shot of the audience. We're not allowed to show this.
So his stuff can't actually fit through there.
Yeah, this is not good.
So funny.
This is a serious heart palpitation for Solar right now.
Oh boy, this is not how he wanted to go down. The thing is, he wasn't going to get 1-1 for these roaches. That's not how you do a build like this. If you're playing against 3 hatch, you want to get the plus right. 1, so you're two-shotting Lings and you're killing roaches more quickly, and that roach speed, so you can kind of out-micro your opponent because they do have more larva, they do have a slightly larger economy.
Oh, this is funny. Now he's just going to push out here and take a third.
Whoa.
Lings almost denying that.
Not quite, though, huh?
No, unfortunately for him, not. The Lings are now going to try to come around and get some scouting in here, which would have been pretty handy. One of the things about when you do try to set up a wall in like that and you do it right is that in this case, Leenock would have to do a lot more heavy lifting to try to figure out exactly what's going on. But he does go ahead and get in there and get a read.
Now, I'd expect that he's going to go across and pressure a little bit. You don't want to let your opponent just get into roach speed freely. And with his plus one and roach speed finishing, this is the one moment where Solar actually has some advantages going on. Speed and plus one both on the way for Leenock. So once he gets that up with his third hatch being a lot sooner and having a lot more drones, then Solar will be at a huge deficit. So he needs to go and work off the build order by microing his units. And so I'm super surprised that he's just sitting there.
Yeah, well, when you consider the fact that it's 50 worker to 60 as well in this moment, it does seem oddly passive here from Solar.
Like, what is he?
Although,
I'm confused.
He might have psyched himself out with that weird position where he locked himself inside.
Maybe.
I mean, that's...
And he's been thrown off several times. He was making a spine twice, canceled two spines
basically,
so far.
Basically, at the highest level of play, it's almost never acceptable in StarCraft II, really, for that to ever happen.
To kill your own buildings?
Well, just to have a whoopsies moment where... Okay, now I have to take out this building. So everybody's watching that I made a mistake. It's so apparent, even to a fairly new player. And that can kind of get you off a rhythm a little bit. Leenock's actually about to finish up two important upgrades. Let's see if he decides to move out at all here. Ravager's now being made over here for Solar. And the same thing here for Leenock. And it seems like Leenock's realized he may have enough momentum to come out here and try to punish.
Yeah, like he's got the same upgrades and then more units because he had three bases quicker. And Solar never did anything.
Ravager versus Ravager, a lot of times the corrosive vials create an artificial no man's land where neither side can really push in too much further. As you can see here, that's going to drive them back. Yeah,
they're kind of like terrible force fields.
Yeah, well, the funny thing about corrosive vials is, especially in this matchup, they usually don't connect with anything, but the fact that you have to move out of the way is the real strength of it. Good job there. Comes in there and takes out those creep tumors. Oh, is he just going to go for it?
Well, he's he's trying to push in and trade a little bit here at least. I think that Leenock rightly realizes that he is ahead. So anytime he, like, if he can trade one roach for one roach over and over towards infinity, he'll win.
Okay, nicely done. He has a few roaches coming up here at the top. Looks like he's going for the queens and not actually any drones here. But meanwhile, at the bottom, he does dive in.
Ooh,
actually moving past the corrosive vials here.
Yeah, realizes that Solar missplit there just a little bit. But then Solar does come down with the rest of his units after dealing with the top there.
Solar deciding that he has enough. He can go all the way over here. The Ravager is in some way body blocking just a little bit here. The roaches can't quite get behind. So we actually see Leenock suffering some serious losses. Some corrosive vials do connect with Solar's army. But it doesn't seem to be enough to phase him. To turn around, he's now pushing across the map. By the way, Leenock does have an additional base, which could be attacked here by Solar.
Not just an additional base, but he has been up so many drones for so long. As long as he just doesn't die, you know, like, I'm still not sure what Solar's game plan is. Like,
well, I mean, it's a very basic way to win, but it is the rules of StarCraft. Is, you know, you're mining more, you get a bigger army, and it doesn't necessarily matter how fancy. Or tactical your opponent is, sometimes you just have more of everything. And that's certainly the game the game that we're seeing here, and that could be the direction this goes into to give Leenock a win. It's 163 to 188. Leenock basically just more of everything and growing at a faster rate.
And the fact that Leenock has a spire in the way as well, and he's like almost maxed out here. Look at this. It's like if Leenock just maxes on roaches and then as Solar attacks, builds a few mutas. What, like, I don't know, I'm just watching this game and I'm like kind of surprised how Solar's playing it. Like, none of this super makes sense to me, right? He was behind on build order basically the whole game. The one time where he had an advantage in upgrades, and he knew he had an advantage in upgrades, he didn't do anything. And so, I don't know.
Okay, It's a tough position for Leenock to try to breach. He may loop around down here to the bottom. In fact, Solar peeking up to see if his opponent's staying down there. Whether it's an all-out kill or he's just keeping Solar restricted to three bases, either one can come through with a victory. Now, this angle is bad for Leenock. He has to back up now. He's also not sending out the right number of roaches to try to throw his opponent off, so he's sending out a second group. There are eight mutas on the way, by the way.
And eight mutas, they will put a lot of damage down on that army. You just start targeting down Ravagers, and over time, that's going to be great. Like, mutas don't deal as much as roaches. It takes a little bit for them to pay off, but Leenock should be able to pull this off. He has to be very careful with his main army. The number one way people lose doing this strategy that Leenock is doing is if they overcommit this army before the mutas get there. Like, if he loses a huge chunk of this army, we might see Solar just run over him.
Oh, this angle's very good, though, actually. Yeah. It's going to be almost impossible here for Solar to try to come back in here and break this. With enough corrosive vials, he can basically stop this army from trying to come in. That being said, Solar does get a good amount of that army up there on the top. But again, it's the mutas that are going to come in here and do so much damage, now hitting all of these different Ravagers.
Yeah, look at that. Just targeting those Ravagers down so quickly. Great play.
Did Leenock, in fact, overextend? I'm not sure. No, I guess with this many mutas.
I think it was okay. It was just barely fine, I think. Like, his mutas got in. They've dealt so much damage. He even sacked a few roaches so the mutas would get more fighting time. And look at this. He's still up 10 drones.
Yeah.
Still, to this day, to this moment, up drones.
And the moment that Solar gets a lead, it immediately then goes right back into Leenock. He just has enough money. He can keep producing. He's got the larvae. He's got everything. So he's once again going to try to take this army on head-on. The only real solid defense against this for the time being is Queens, which, of course, are not going to be able to fight anything in the middle of the map if there's no creep there. And we saw earlier in this game that Solar was denying creep being pushed out at all.
Look at this. Right now, Hydralisk's being made. Of course, he's going to have to do that. But Leenock is just remaxing on Roach Ravager. And this is going to be a very quick-to-remax composition. He can start to roam around a bit more. Hydralisks give you more DPS in your army. It makes a technically better army, but it's still going to be hard for him to fight against this. Leenock has some mobility. He has just advantages all over the place.
So the mutas come back down, and just taking out anything that's mining over here is annoying enough. And once again, a big attack up here at the top. Now, there are some Hydras coming out. I'm not clear if there's going to be enough so far, because the mutas could always come back up here. Mutas don't tend to fare that well against Hydras, but if you have enough mutas, they kill the Hydras off pretty quickly. It seems like this army, even though angle-wise seems to be good, for Solar, there's too much for Leenock, and he takes game one. GG. Once again, Leenock now 3-0 against Solar.
Yeah, he's really killing him. Solar's EBZ is not on point today against Leenock. Leenock has played aggressive plays, and now he's played a greedy play there. Had the lead the entire game. Solar just seemed a bit off. Like, he was thrown off. He walled himself in all the way. He started two spines that he then canceled because no aggression was actually coming. Solar needs to clear his mind right now and play some better StarCraft.
Well, he can absolutely still take it. He just has to win these next two games. He has to forget about the three losses he's already suffered. Leenock, I can't imagine he's not really confident that he's going to advance right now.
Oh, yeah. He's just thinking about that group selection, man. Round of 16.
Yeah.
I hope Innovation doesn't choose me.
Okay. Our second map is going to be Ascension to IR. It seems like no matter what the map, Leenock has a better start all the way to the finish. Solar, somebody who's actually seen a lot more success in StarCraft II in his career, may in fact be knocked out in the round of 32. From here on out, Solar cannot make any more mistakes. Leenock is really reversing any opinions we had of him as far as this matchup goes. Now 3-0 against him. Our map is now loading up. Let's see if Solar can begin that comeback in game number two, or if Leenock is going to close this out and be the second player to advance to the round of 16 in the GSL.
GSL Season 1, CODES, Daybreak. When the lights come out.
In the upper left, in the blue, our Zerk player.
Titan EX1, Leenock.
N in the bottom right, and the red are other Zerg player.
Splunts, Solar.
I really wonder what's going on in Solar's head right now. He probably did not expect to really lose any games here against Leenock, which puts him in a really weird spot. You know, when you're playing StarCraft and you're against somebody you clearly think you're better than, you know, you maybe have more accomplishments or you have a better reputation or a better ranking, and you lose the first game, obviously you're going to be pretty salty.
Sure.
But then when you start to lose the second and the third and you haven't taken a game off them,
eventually you got to reevaluate.
Yeah, and you're in your mind, you're having to then take yourself down a few notches.
Two what?
It's
you're trying to tell us something. No, yeah, you're quite right.
I mean, that's tough.
And look at Leenock once again going double hatch before pool against just Solar playing safely.
Well, I mean, with Leenock having all these victories under his belt, I mean, you can start to get creative when you're ahead in a series. Oh, sometimes yeah. Risks can pay off. It's not uncommon in a best of three that the player that wins game two does something risky. Wins game one, does something risky in game two.
Leenock has won so many games against Solar at this point. If this was MLG, Solar would have to win like 15 in a row to take this.
Yeah. Although I will say game one between these two looked a little bit funny. Solar's opening, or he was sort of doing the same thing as Leenock, but just slower. Was a little bit weird, especially to see that in a mirror matchup with two players of this caliber.
Are you talking the game we just saw?
Yeah, the game we just saw.
Well, if you rush up to the plus one in the speed, you don't have to worry too much against the three-hatch player. They have to make a lot of Lings and Roaches to hold until they have Roach speed.
Right.
And that forces them to have less drones as well. So the fact he did not poke at all, he must have just – he was afraid the whole time. It's like he thinks that there's going to be a bunch of Lings coming to kill his base or his drones or something. I don't know, man. He didn't have a good wall, like, so many things went wrong. But Solar trying to put on a little tiny bit of aggression. He's droning behind this, so this is just a poke. He forces some drones away, lost mining time. Good stuff.
Okay, once again, the Ling's now forced to back up. I think this game should look a little bit more clean here from Solar. We see him trying to come in here, trying to get that queen. Does not manage to actually get any kills there, as Leenock's doing a very good job of positioning the queen in between the extractor, or the super would-be extractor, and then the mineral patch. Same thing he was doing with the drones.
Well,
this can really turn into a big Ling versus Ling fight, and that's what we're going to have here from Leenock. He's actually about to burst out of the map. Ling speed,
that's cool.
Four Banelings.
I like this.
14 more Lings coming, and I don't know if Solar's going to be ready.
He went into just macro play last time he did this build, so this time he's like, nah, just mix up. Just the amount that he's mixing up his games, I really appreciate this from Leenock. He's turning on the aggression. I think that this is what Solar thought was going to happen last game.
Yeah.
And this game, he doesn't have a wall or anything.
So there's two Banelings running in here now.
Oh, boy.
We need to see if those connect with anything.
But
the real attack should actually be... he only has to get one, by the way, because the one Baneling doesn't really do anything to the drones. It takes two Baneling shots to kill a drone. Now, is he actually doing enough damage over here? There's more Banelings being made. Solar moving around in the middle. He's trying to snipe any Banelings that come his way.
Sending some Lings across, too. I'm not sure how many drones that Baneling hit. As we clicked away, it might have hit quite a few. So this little group of Lings he's sending in could kill a ton of drones over there. Yeah, look at this. I think it did damage quite a few of those.
As you can see, oh!
Okay, not bad. Not
seven
bad.
Kills there.
Solar did get four of Leenock's.
Leenock now taking out yet another drone. It doesn't seem like the aggression is done yet here for Leenock either. Two Banelings might try to push in here. He's in fact going to try to go for one of these groups of Lings. Not sure if this Baneling's going to do much more. I don't know what the HP is on these drones, so it's hard to say. Okay, again, a few more kills there. Now up to 11.
Oh,
and
God.
Leenock's not letting up. In fact, there's 14 more Lings being made.
Oh, the single Baneling. Ooh. Good connection, but still quite a few Lings left over here for Leenock.
It seemed like that Baneling was going to kill more, but in the end it really didn't. And there's more Banelings coming in here. Now keep in mind, some of these drones are already bruised from the previous attack.
Oh my God.
And maybe only one Baneling connect necessary
to
wipe these out.
Oh! Ooh.
Great
Very
job.
Nice.
There's been 23 drones killed now.
Okay, Solar is just a bit below Leenock in drones despite that.
Yeah, very true.
It's you know, a 6-drone deficit is not something that is impossible to come back from, but definitely momentum on Leenock's side at the moment.
Okay, it looks like Solar does manage to come in here and deny some more banelings being made. The third base, though, still not really being mined from. Good baneling connect wipes out that group over there for Solar, and I think actually the third hatchery can't be kept up, but instead Leenock not going for the hatch, wants to try to push even further in here and take out more workers. Very good decision-making here by Leenock.
Yeah, look at now, all those Banes, man. Like, this is not going to be stoppable. Well, you're not going to stop that many Banes unless you have, like, a lot of Banes yourself.
It's going to be a battering ram. I mean, there's no way you can really slow down this from coming in here and taking out your workers. Look at the split. The drones are cornered. GG!
Wow.
Leenock 4-0-ing Solar. Big upset here tonight.
Yeah.
And that means Leenock is going to move on to the round of 16 along with Innovation.
Well, this is kind of refreshing, I have to say. As much as I love Solar and love to see him advance far in tournaments, he's a great sir, great style. I'm sure he'll do well this year. You know, wouldn't even be surprised to see a tournament win from him, as is sometimes the case. But tonight, unable to do it. Even against Creator, he had some shakiness.
He did. I feel for Solar. This is a very bad start to 2018.
Yeah.
Somebody, I think, almost everybody was positive would actually move on. Thoroughly stopped here by Leenock.
Yeah.
Solar unable to even take a game off of him.
Yeah.
Crazy.
Well, Leenock is a force to be reckoned with in that ZBZ matchup. I think he might be an earlier pick for someone like Innovation, though, in the group phase.
Our second player to advance to the round of 16. Congratulations, Leenock. Thank you. So, Leenock, how do you feel after your victory? I think I was really lucky, honestly. I feel very blessed. I'm just really glad I won. You won every match against Solar. What did you think about your games against him? Well, in the past, I always said, in the ZBZ, you just never know who's going to win. But all I can say is that I feel almost like I got lucky. Are there any moments you felt like you were your best against Solar? Well, when I faced Solar, I thought he might go for really conservative builds against me, so for the past 2 days, I was actually a little bit sick for the last 2 days. I was ill, so I wasn't able to prep that much. So instead to prep, I just watched older games and try to prep the games in my head instead. And I think because I put a lot of thought in this, I had a lot of different strategies I could pull off every single game, and I think that's what allowed me to win. But before we started the GSL, we had an interview, and you said that you might bomb out, but also that you joined a new team. Yeah, very recently I got an offer to join a new team. And the team said as long as you qualify for GSL, they'll be happy. So that's how I ended up joining this team. I'm very happy. He says, you never know when this bomb's going to go off, so expect more great games from me in the future. So do you have any goals for this year? First of all, I think what's most important is I just play games with confidence. That happened today. I didn't feel nervous at all. I feel like maybe Teja was like me in the past. I'm hoping to be like the Zerg version of Teja.
Blast from the past there.
We haven't really seen you last year, but we hope to see you a lot more this time around, Leenock. Any words to your fans?
Always, 제가 게임을 하든 쉬든 응원해 주시는 팬분들이 계세요. 정말 너무 감사드리고
There's been fans who've been consistently supportive of me, even when I've been performing well or not performing well. I know I took a long break, but I have practiced hard recently, so I hope you guys keep supporting for me. And before we close this, Leenock, I have one more question. I want to hear what you want to say to Innovation. I don't know what to say. I didn't catch that last part. All right. That does it for the interview. Ending it on an awkward note. Okay.
Would it be StarCraft?
That's right. So, that's what we're all about in here. We embrace the awkward.
Decent first day of GSL. I did think today this was one of the groups that was like more one-sided, but not if it wasn't how I thought it would go. Like, I thought it would be Solar very easily getting out of the group.
Well,
but
whenever you have a group where it seems like it's clear who's going to move on and who doesn't, it's always exciting when there is an upset.
Yeah.
It really does show you that it's not always the exact same players in the exact same place skill-wise. You know, this is a constantly evolving and changing thing. Again, no surprise to see Innovation move on. He won in a very Innovation-esque way.
There's really bopped everybody.
Yeah, he took him to Bop Town. Yeah. He turned him into Beep and Bop and ate him.
That's so stupid.
So,
oh my God.
Really no shocker there. How far will Innovation go in this tournament? Quite possibly all the way to the finals.
Oh, yeah.
But we got to see.
He's a defending champ.
Now, one of the players I am most excited about is sort of.
And this is a killer group. Everyone has a chance to come out of this group. Biol had a very weak year last year in comparison to what he normally does, which is domination. But I'm thinking he's going to be in good shape right now. The games I've seen of him have been good. SOS is on fire right now.
That's
completely
right.
Completely on fire. So that'll be fun. And Deer is always the most underrated Protoss in the world. So all this plus Sort of's first GSL. I love
it.
Yeah,
welcome to the GSL, Codas, Sort of. We are excited to see your games. Of course, it's always fun for us, and I guess all of our viewers, actually even for the Korean viewers, to have a non-Korean down here.
Yeah.
This is sort of
and
the
Mr.
dream
Mechanics
of
Mechanics himself. I mean, come on.
Wait, what'd you say?
Mr. Mechanics himself.
Yeah.
I think SOS is a tough match for him just because it's like SOS.
Sure.
And like, sort of tries to play perfect games. He's kind of like Neo Hydra in the way he plays, in my opinion. But hopefully he can stop whatever SOS has to throw at him. I think there's a chance that he can get out of there.
I certainly think there is. It's a new year. We're already seeing some different results. Not all different, Innovation moving on. But it is fun to see who advances, who doesn't, especially when you're in a new version of StarCraft 2. By the way, God, it's so good to be back.
I know.
I start to feel really weird when I'm not back in the studio consistently casting StarCraft 2.
Yeah. This is like, this is my normal, is this.
Yeah.
I need this. This is like my insulin.
And you're severely diabetic. Yeah.
A StarCraft diabetic or something. How does this work?
That was beautiful. Yes.
I need GSL, so I'm happy it's back.
By the way, we filled up the studio.
Oh, yeah. It was crazy today.
So, guys, thank you guys for coming down here.
Yeah. Probably everyone was like, it's opening day. They're definitely doing pizza today.
No! All right, guys. That does it for today. We will see you again on Wednesday at 6:30 p.m. KST. Have a good morning, afternoon, or night, wherever you are. We love you. See you again soon.
GSL Season 1, Codas, Daybreak.